WXRK, New York, 92.3 K-Rock. Great rock, period.
Each Sunday, in the early hours, as the sun goes blood red, then fades to darkness, three wee lads, one of them far more weird than the other two, leave their womenfolk behind and journey to an empty radio station in New York City. There, they rise up against the bloody rubbish of the radio industry that plays the same 15 songs off a hard drive and gives away tickets to crap concerts. This is the Lazlow Show, starring Big Wayne.
You banged a homeless girl, Wayne?
Yeah, she lived in a car. She wasn't homeless.
Well, you were on crack. You didn't know.
No, that was the girl who left me that I turned to the crack.
The girl that was living in a car, she broke your heart.
Yes.
Why? Was she pulled away?
And Reed, who wears a dress and rides a scooter.
You know, I need to watch lots of porn so I know what I can be against.
And Cousin Ed, whose girlfriend hasn't got grass on the pitch, if you know what I mean.
So, she said she's 18 in December? Not that bad.
One show, fighting to show them we're no dogs but men. Men who remember freedom, where 16-year-olds can drink and listen to metal music and smoke at bars and get into high-speed accidents. Men who have punch cards at Planned Parenthood. One show that could be shut down in a moment. Until that moment, this is the Lazlow Show.
We got a radio jingle for you, okay? Okay, because the radio one, you're the one for me.
Lazlow Show. Episode 21. This will be called the Afterglow episode. Audio from what happened after last show's legendary experience, as we will call it. We set in director's chairs at a porn shoot. Comedian Jim Florentine stopping by tonight. Reed Tucker, who is normally a stalker, is now being stalked by a fan. We have evidence and we are going to confront this person. Plus the uncertain future of your radio heroes. There's radio news tonight. But before we start, Dean Gray recently served a cease and desist from your good friends at Warner Brothers Records with a tune called Doctor Who on Holiday.
Yeah.
93 K-Rock. It is the Lazlow Show, episode 21. Also called the Afterglow episode because after our last show, which wasn't last Sunday, it was the Sunday before that, we had Big Wayne's tape viewed by a porn producer and two starlets, and Cousin Ed went to some stupid family event.
How'd I miss that one?
And we were invited to...
thanks for the memo.
A shooting, not like a gun, but we were invited to this porn set, and it was probably the weirdest experience of my entire life.
Weird in a good way.
Yeah, but...
Not for me.
Has it ruined, like, porn for life for you, or...?
You know what? It's like when I first started in radio, my first program director said, you know, once you see how things work behind the scenes...
What do you mean there's no request?
You'll never...
It's all a lie?
You'll never really be able to look at it the same way again. It's like after seeing Wayne's tape, I'm kind of like, I can't really look at...
That would ruin sex for me, period.
It didn't ruin sex for me, but I look at each one of these guys differently.
So you guys saw him naked, sort of.
Yes. And but you know what's weird is...
Full attention, Ed.
Reed and I agreed that...
They want you now, don't they?
Yes, they do. I feel wanted.
That the tape was not as disturbing as the porn shoot was.
They're not even close. You know, the tape was a little grainy. You shot it, what, in the early 80s, 1980s, something,
yes.
1982. So it was hard to tell it was you. You had a big head of hair.
I had a lot of hair. I like that Laz described you. I was cut up.
Cut up. Yeah.
He said, look at you, cut up.
Were the dreads in your beard little
no
niblets at that point?
No, yeah, no dreads beard, at all. Right? Yeah.
No, was little mustache.
No beard?
No beard.
No. If you missed that show, which was episode 19, it's archived in its entirety. Actually, the pre-dump version, because we had to dump out three times. So the uncensored version is at lazlow.com.
That's right, because we had those two girl porn stars in here who couldn't follow directions. The first thing that girl says is, like, clearly something you can't say on radio.
Correct.
After I'd just been, like, a dad and, like, her high school principal and given her a 10-minute lecture about what
Reed
she could
gives
say.
Her this lecture in the hall. And
she's not listening. She's, like, filing her nails and looking at me, like, really just kind of...
And rolling her eyes.
And rolling her eyes, exactly. So I'm like, are you listening to me? Are you going to do anything bad? And then first thing she says on the mic is just, we had to dump out.
I would think porn stars are more psychotic and skitsier and dumber than, like, strippers. So they like got to up that level, and I could just imagine her not listening.
Well, and we've got audio from I interviewed a male porn star at this.
Why,
dude? It was the you got to hear this. It was
at least I don't have to see it.
Plus, Wayne
well, if you've seen it, it
Wayne
was...
is snickering because I'm sitting there because
you're interviewing a male porn star.
Not
hold
just
on,
that.
Ed, let him get to the point.
He pulled his pants down. He pulled his pants down while I'm interviewing him, and I just, like, sort of try to be professional and keep talking.
Yeah, was he like, working, getting ready? Or
yeah, he was,
yeah, that's right.
You were turning him on, and he turned...
No, he was getting his suit on, because...
He's getting into his show, outfit.
His suit?
Yes.
I mean, his raincoat?
No, yeah. He was wearing, like, a full suit, because he had to be...
Oh, okay.
The story was that he was going to purchase art from these two art dealers, and as we all know, when it's time to negotiate with an art dealer, it's time to whip out your junk.
Exactly.
You got to sign it with something, right?
But Ed, the best is, well, Laz is interviewing this guy. The guy drops trowel on his clothes that he's wearing. He's putting on his suit, okay? And as he puts the suit back on, the guy's junk is just like, you know, he just lets it, like, kind of hang out the fly. And Laz just keeps talking to him, and it's like 4 inches away from Laz's belt buckle as the guy's talking to him.
And I hear Wayne snickering over there. I want to punch him.
You got to laugh at that. The guy just had no shame.
He had no reason to have shame.
Well, that's true, too. That's
I would have
true.
Thrown a $20 bill on the ground and see if Laz would better pick it up. Take a quick picture.
And with a name like Dino Bravo, that's his name.
But true, you know, considering what you saw him do like 5 minutes after you were interviewing him, that seems sort of tame. Do you think
exactly.
that, like, if that scarred you, then what you saw next?
It was the weirdest experience. We had director's chairs at this thing, and, you know, we were all pumped up and high from doing the show, and it was, we had an incredible show, got a ton of feedback. Dude, I got email from Africa.
Africa?
On that show. Ooh. Yeah, I'll get to that email. And
wow.
How they... have computers or something evidently there.
How they got electricity.
I don't know. I thought they all had AIDS. I don't know.
There's a big hamster and a big wheel over there.
No, the modem is just they get a little short guy to stand at the computer and... or like really fast.
Short rounds over there.
Short round.
What is that?
That's from Indiana Jones.
Right.
Wow. He was Asian, man.
No, he's over in the woods, you know. I don't know. The Asians are good with computers. You put it all together.
So The Asians are good with computers.
Nice.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else we can offend? Let's say Africa, Asia. Got any Scandinavian stereotypes?
Hey, we're only 11 minutes
out?
In.
Yeah,
give
exactly.
Time. So we're heading to this porn shoot, and Wayne and I are in a cab, and who rides by us?
But Mr. Sirius in a little, it was raining out a little, it was drizzling, and Reed, you were on your scooter, you had no idea we were in the cab next to you.
No way.
Yeah, you were all eyes fully ahead.
You didn't throw anything at me, like
no.
A bottle? Or?
No.
Yeah, okay.
You looked scared already.
Was he white knuckling it?
He looked a little paranoid, yes.
I'm glad I have my own theme music.
But we never told you that we've seen you. But
no.
It was like, you know, also.
Well, I mean, there's nothing to see. I'm just sitting there driving. What do you want to
do? Yeah, but you had this crazy look on your face.
No, come on.
You did.
There's a lot of yellows around you, a lot of yellow cab. You were like, wow, I better watch what I'm doing.
You have to be careful, man. You're looking killed out there.
When I play GTA now, I'd like to steal a scooter and feel like I'm Reed running around.
running to stuff.
How good is the scooter to drive in GTA, huh?
But it's called Faggio or something.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
So we're walking to this porn shoot, which is on like the 12th floor or something.
Some photo studio in Chelsea, right?
Right. Yeah. And so we're walking outside, and Wayne is is calling his girl, right? He's calling his wife
to get permission.
No,
no, I.
They called
me
again. Listen, you have a train schedule that changed today.
He's calling about the train schedule. He's like, this may take a while, honey. He doesn't say there's no permission.
No, I just, we knew we wanted to know when the next train was.
I'm going on a porn shoot, and okay.
I know. Well, as soon as we got there and those girls got naked, Wayne was like, I don't care, Lazlow. I'm staying all night. I will sleep on the street. I am not taking the train anywhere. He was in for the long haul.
By the time we got home, I was so pumped up. I think I got 3 hours sleep. I went to work. I thought for sure the next day I'd come home and go right to bed. I was up till 11 o'clock at night.
Calling your friends?
No, he was carpenter he works with. every carpenter he works with in the whole company wanted to know all about Wayne's big porn night.
They got nothing done. It was just like Reed telling everybody individually what happened.
No, he came over and showed me how many minutes he'd been on the phone that day.
Oh, yes.
So we go upstairs, and we really don't know what to expect. You know, I mean, what does a porn set really look like? And
they go to a
not
pitching?
Much, apparently.
You definitely don't need a whole
they
lot of...
They spent $6 on the set.
And the couch was borrowed.
Who's getting that back after what's gone on there?
Yeah,
it's like, here you go.
It's actually in one of these clips. So here, we arrive on the set.
Okay, here we are. We're on the top floor.
12A?
12B. Walking in.
And I had to, I thought it was going to be like the two chicks, the guy, and the director, maybe a lighting guy.
Right.
There was a ton of people there.
It was like watching a soccer game in Manchester.
Were there like guys?
Like chairs lined up.
We're like friends of the director, like sitting around drinking beers and watching. And,
yeah.
Oh, we'll get to the people that were watching.
I think there was people that paid money to be there.
Yeah, that was weird.
They were weird.
Oh, no.
It's like old times.
We're here.
A pleasure.
Yeah, dude. Thanks. We had a blast, man.
I'm glad, man.
We had a good...
And that's Joe Gallant, who was on the show. He's the producer. And I have to say, after the porn DVDs that he gave us during this show, Reed and Wayne both went home and viewed them and called me traumatized.
I'm hooked.
Were traumatized at first.
Oh, yeah. There's a complete shock value you have to get over first, Ed. But then after that, you say to yourself, all right, what else is there left for this guy to do? I mean, that's how crazy it gets. Am I right, Reed?
I think that his videos are in the genre called alternative, which in porn, you know, that is out there, brother.
Okay.
Like, what's going on?
I don't think we can really talk about it.
But what we saw that night, what they were filming, was fairly tame, I think, compared to what he normally
does.
Yes. Yeah.
This was, you know... Evidently, when people are a little constipated and things like that, things can happen.
There was a lot
of colonics. I think that's a good word.
Right.
Yeah.
So, yeah. He does.
I don't want to see that.
Yeah,
but you do, because after a while you want to know how much further can he go with it? What's the next step?
No. You know what? I want to see a videotape of the people buying that, because I want to know.
Right.
What
you're going to see me buying it, because I need more shock value.
Right. It's going to be Wayne.
I need the whole Joe Gallant box set.
And also, have you ever seen, Wayne, a porn shoot that produces art on a canvas, and yes. that's really all I can say.
Yeah.
Right.
Oh. Yeah, because evidently you can you know.
Yeah. We won't. We
like
won't.
Paint. You can.
Yes, I know what you're talking about.
You okay.
So my wife went to the website, and there are canvases for sale.
Yeah.
And they're pricey.
So,
how you doing, man? Thanks for coming, dude.
Nice
show. We really enjoyed it. Thank you.
So,
no, it was good.
Do you know your lines?
Yeah, my line is, I'm gay.
So, and, you know, which was always sort of my joke about what I say to prostitutes, you know, I'm gay,
right.
just leave me alone or whatever. And that one porn star actually thought I was gay.
Well, yeah, both of them confided in me afterwards. I've given them a Three Musketeers to thank them for being here.
Is that what you call it, Reed?
Yeah.
Is that
really?
What we call it now, a Three Musketeers?
That's the budget of the show.
I hear that's alternative.
Yes,
yeah, exactly.
Was it a floater? Or
I smooshed it on a canvas, and it's for sale for $3,000. No, the girls were a little jealous that we didn't have candy for them, so I hooked her up.
Yeah.
But she was like, is that guy really gay?
Isn't that terrible when a porn star thinks I'm gay?
So I don't know if you should be more offended that they actually thought that you were gay or that they completely didn't get your joke when you were making a joke that about you were
there
gay.
There were several jokes that I made.
Yeah, they just sort of
just sort of like the third just, grade reading level.
There was a blank slate there.
Yeah, my line is, I'm gay.
Do you want to be in the movie?
No.
Just to say that line?
I think my wife might get a little bugged out.
As you can tell, I'm getting a little bugged out.
Yeah, you quickly bust out that whole wife thing, you know? It's like, oh, I have a wife.
Would your wife be upset if you were in a porn but you didn't do anything? You were just an extra, just like walk by and said, I'm gay and kept going?
You know what? And I thought about it for a second and... No, but I think I would be more freaked out where it would come back to haunt me in like 3 or 4 years.
People would take it out of context saying you were at a porn.
Yeah, I mean, you know.
I ain't worried about that. If Joe needs an extra next time, I'm willing to walk on.
So have you shot anything yet?
No, we're about to do still photos.
Still photos?
And then we're going to go right into the scene.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, just tell us to we'll stay out of the way.
Cool.
What if Wayne gets excited?
Just tell me and I'll bring the camera over.
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
You've already seen everything he has to offer. So.
Yeah.
He
says if you get excited.
In the corner like doing a little red, like a little red stick like a dog.
Off.
Yeah, you can pull off. Yeah,
I very well may. I very well may.
Thanks for
thank you for the.
Thank you.
You couldn't tell if the guy was kidding.
He wasn't kidding. He wasn't kidding.
He wasn't.
He wasn't
no.
kidding.
No.
He was like, you know, do you want to get excited? You know, if you get excited. Maybe you can come be part of it. And I was like,
Or just be part of it in your own way over in the corner and nobody will mind.
Well, yeah.
Did he not say that?
At one point when I looked around, there were quite a few people getting into it.
I'm thinking that's a lucrative business. That's the next step, you know, to have live pornos. You come to the shoot and you pay like, you know, $50, you get a beer, you get a, you know, a little chair in the corner.
Yeah. Well, in Amsterdam they have that
exactly.
And it's just dull.
It is boring.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, it's it looks like modern dance or something. It's so choreographed.
It's
and
like
just,
watching a talk show that's like not live. I went to like the Dana Carvey show, and it's like a half-hour sitcom, but you sit there for 3 hours as they redo every bit.
Oh,
yeah, right.
So you had a good time in Amsterdam,
Reed? Well, you have to go. If you ever go to Amsterdam, don't tell me you haven't been to those things.
So you got to smoke the pot, you got to go to the prostitutes.
Right, and then you got to ride a boat in the canal. I think those are the three things.
Is that what they call it now?
Yeah.
Ride a boat in the canal.
That's after you give her the Three Musketeer.
I'm speaking entirely in euphemism
right.
this entire show.
So I went over to talk to...
Not in the world of Joe Gallant, you know.
We went over to talk to Haley Scott. Was that her name?
Yes,
she
was her name.
She was getting ready as much as they can.
And it was fun
she's
watching
the
them
star,
get ready.
Right?
Yeah, she was the one
star.
Of the, yeah.
One of two.
So this is the big prep session?
No. No. The what's big a, prep session.
What's this? You have a tape of
a makeup person?
I usually always have a makeup person.
So now she's, you know, going on about how she typically has a makeup person, which I don't know if I believe because this is such a run and gun operation. It's like we've got a couch, we've got some like you know those lights that you hang in the garage from the ceiling when you're changing the oil.
Yeah,
and mm-hmm. We're shooting porn.
And what part does the makeup person work on here?
I don't know.
Like the razor burn or is it like eyeliner?
I think they each have their own specialty above the waist and then below.
Oh, there's above the waist makeup artist and
I don't know, maybe. But there was definitely spare. She was just sitting there at a card table and just busted out a thing of blush and was just sitting there alone.
Right, but she could have used some on that ass because it was honky.com.
I usually always have a makeup person, yes.
Really?
Yes.
Now, you've got your Social Security card out. Is that part of the...
That is part of the drill.
All right.
You have to get your social and your ID, or your ID and your passport, or your social and your passport, to make sure that you are of age. And who you are.
Where do they keep that?
Yeah, there are no pockets. But wasn't that weird, Lazlow? Do you remember that when
leather wallet?
All of the stars, who I think even Dino Bravo was probably naked at this point, and yes. He just had to. The still photographer came over, and each of the stars just standing there naked held up their passport on one side of their face and their social security card on the other side of the face, and the photographer just took a couple pictures for the records.
Yeah,
it was weirdly just sort of bureaucratic, you know.
I think it's also because the Bush administration and the Justice Department has solved the terrorism problem. And they passed that. No, they passed that rule that you have to have documentation now, like very strict documentation that all people that are in the movies or in the pictures are of age. And if you don't, you can go to prison.
Right.
That's what the Justice Department is working on now.
Well, thank goodness for that.
Right. So.
Weeding out the porn star terrorist, I guess.
Right. There are no terrorists. They've all been defeated.
You should see how they sneak their bombs in.
Fill in your passport to make sure that you are of age and who you are.
Are you going to be a little nervous performing with us here?
No.
Okay.
Do you want me to be nervous?
No, I'm a little nervous.
You are?
Yes.
You're lying.
I am.
You're nervous to sit here and
sure.
Watch porn?
Sure.
You're not even anything.
I know. I might,
Why don't you smoke one of those? Anything else than bathing
wipes is in the drugstore. Wait.
So this guy comes
over.
Yeah,
did you just hear that?
I would smoke one of those.
No, I had a cigar, actually, in my mouth.
I was going to smoke the outside of it, man.
No. No, I actually had some small cigars, and thank God, because I gave one to Wayne, and by the time we walked out of the building at the end of the night, it was like the end looked like an exploding cigar because I've been sitting there chewing on it, just gritting my teeth.
All your nails are gone. Yeah, that was awkward. But then so you got cut off because I think one of the PAs came in and yelled, "Okay, I'm back from Dwayne Reed, and I've got the baby wipes."
Baby wipes are evidently
a very important point to shooting porn.
To get your social and your ID, or your ID and your passport, or your social and your passport, to make sure that you are of age and who you are.
Are you going to be a little nervous performing with us here?
No.
Okay.
Do you want me to be nervous?
No, I'm a little nervous.
You are?
Yes.
You're lying.
I am.
You're nervous to sit here and
sure.
Watch porn?
Sure.
You're not even doing anything.
I know. I might,
Why don't you smoke one of those?
Anything else than baby wipes is in the drugstore.
Baby wipes?
Nope.
What are the baby wipes for?
That's what we're doing in scene. It's
okay.
Just like good.
Yeah.
I mean, you get lube all over you, like all over your hands, and all over your ass and stuff. So you want to like get it off, especially if you're doing something like on somebody's couch. You don't want to get
this is something so that you've borrowed that couch
and greasy and stuff. You don't want to get lube all over everybody's stuff,
right?
You know. So it's
you ever used olive oil?
No.
No. Big Wayne's been known.
Like olive oil, huh?
Yeah, all over a couch with the girls slipping and sliding around.
He just flipped the cushions.
I did flip the cushions.
He tried.
It went through.
Now, yeah.
What is? Tell me the story again. How did olive oil come into the scene?
I was, you know, I had a chance, an opportunity with a young lady to get some
action.
From the
abnormal variety.
Correct.
Yes.
Of the alternative cut.
It was either that or Valvoline.
And, you know, spit really wasn't cutting it. So I was in a building where my mother operated like a commercial kitchen. And I took like a 1 gallon jug of olive oil.
Mom, can I borrow some olive oil?
No, she wasn't around, Ed. But anyway, I took like this 1 gallon can, you know, and I used it very
a gallon
lucratively, if you know what I'm saying. It was definitely a lot of schmear and it splashed.
Lucratively.
You used
liberally.
It.
And when I... Yeah, come on, do you want me to tell the story? You're going to laugh at my vocabulary. Which is it?
That is a great one.
But anyway, after a while, kind of, you know, when we got done, it kind of just all oozed down and went right to the couch. So me, thinking, like how you said, turn the cushion over, no problem, but it was too late.
Nice.
You know what really turned me on about her was that, you know, she was the one that gave me the 10 for the socks in my own video.
Yeah, we had Porn Idol on the last show, and everybody had to sort of rate performance.
And I didn't do that bad, Ed.
And on clothing,
you did well.
Because all Wayne wore through the entire thing were socks. That were like knee high with the stripes on them from some football team.
Packers.
But correct. This right. one that the chick I was just talking to there found it hot that the bottom of the socks looked like he'd been sliding across a wood floor all day.
You got to have something to stick out, you know.
But the best was, Ed, is during the middle of her shoot, she turns around and realizes that the bottom of her feet are filthy black. And she's yelling for baby wipes, and I'm finding it to be a turn on. Kind of like them dirty.
Dirty feet fetish.
That is so messed
probably
up.
See, that's why I belong in that world, maybe. I'm starting to realize maybe I'm going to that world.
So then the guy Dino Bravo... I go over to, and first thing off the bat is he starts going on about how nobody talks to the male porn stars.
Probably not his real name, too. We just want to point out, do you think? Wait. Dino Bravo. Sounds like something on the Cartoon Network.
Haven't you ever heard of that formula, how you figure out your porn name? You're supposed to take the name of your first pet.
Okay.
And the name, your last name would be the first street you lived on.
That's exactly what one of them said. That's exactly how they said, but I don't...
Yeah, but...
I'm trying to think of...
No.
So he grew up on Bravo Avenue, is that what you're saying?
I would be Patches Truman. I don't
know. Sounds like a president's wife.
I know. Right, exactly. So I start...
Sounds like you're a receiver.
And not the football kind. Yeah.
I've taken a Three Musketeers bar here and there.
I'm open for anything now.
You guys are disgusting. So here's... Here's our good friend Dino Bravo. Now, the man is at one point of this interview has this junk a little too close to me for my comfort.
It's always the chicks on the radio.
Yeah, I mean, you don't ever, you know, unless it's someone famous like Ron Jeremy or you know, someone who's been around a long time, you know. So, but yeah, ask me whatever you want. Go ahead, man.
So there's a lot of discrimination.
Well, I mean, that's what makes the business go around. People watch for the chicks. I'm just saying, as watching the media, you don't see the guys get interviewed that much. I just was wondering, you know, because when I meet people and they find out what I do for a living, I do get a lot of questions.
Right. You would think, like, what do you do? I am like Wayne. I'm a carpenter. What do you do? I bang for a living.
Yeah, and he finds something to complain about, yet still. You're a porn star. Look what you do for a living, and he's complaining. And he's like, nobody talks to me.
Well, that's because, you know, the chicks just came back, and they were like, oh, we were just on, you know, the biggest radio station in New York City, you know, we were on the Lazlow Show, blah, blah, blah. And then, you know, he wasn't asked, so I think he was a little, his feelings were hurt, you know? But he got to...
Right.
Well, he's on tonight.
What I do for a living, I do get a lot of questions. Women too. You always have the chicks on. You should have some guy that's been on.
Well, you're going to be our first porn guy.
Oh, okay. All right. Gotcha. All right. Well, then ask away.
The girls, you meet girls and you tell them what you do. Does it ever end up resulting in a little action?
No, hell no. Are you kidding me? No. Women run the other way, unless they're amongst our business.
See, but you would think that a chick would be somewhat into that, because it's... You know,
obviously, he's good.
Dude, I have to say, after watching this guy, and it is very weird...
So you were watching him?
Well, it was him and two chicks during this shoot.
Well, I would be watching the chicks.
Well, I was watching chicks.
Right. That's what I'm saying. See, you were gay. Oh, God. Chewing on the cigar, watching the guy.
Dude, I'm telling you, it was the most surreal experience. The best part, though, is when the chicks are just moaning, oh, yeah, yeah, and they go, and cut, and they jump off, and they're like, so anyway, I was talking to my agent, and I'm like,
right, or run
this
off,
is all fake.
run yeah, off to the bathroom to clean themselves immediately.
Right. I was like, this is, they were making they were faking it.
That's right.
You don't think anybody's ever faked with you?
You wonder sometimes when you're watching a porn, like, it's got to be a one moment when it's real.
Now that I've seen it, no.
There's not been a porn star who's been, like, in the middle of a shoot and she really does get off.
Oh, I'm sure.
Maybe, but not these girls.
I'm sure they all get off when the check gets deposited in their bank account.
I'm telling you, dude, the way they turned it on and off of just howling and moaning and then cut, and then it's like... You know?
See, I think they become numb to sex then, and I wouldn't want that, because then sex would suck when you're not at work.
Yeah. The whole thing was just so sterile, because you remember when they came in, the two girls were already there, and then Dino shows up. They don't introduce themselves to each other. They don't say anything. There's no introductions at all. No hello. There's no kissing ever. It's just like, okay, and ready, go. And then the girls
are bang,
just...
Bang, bang,
bang. Bang. No words exchanged between Dino and the girls.
They're amongst our business.
Have you worked with these chicks before?
Yes, I have, actually. I've worked with one of them, with Mia, not with Haley, but...
Ever a chick you're like, no way?
Oh, all the time, dude, but you gotta do it, man. I wouldn't...
Gotta take one for the team.
Yeah.
But hey, I mean, even if you're not in porn, you've done that. You know, it's the end of the night, you're a little drunk, and you're like, you know what? She's fat, but I'm riding her.
So he has not been with the girl Haley before?
Right, he's been with Mia Bang.
Did you ask him if he was looking forward to, I mean, do you look forward to being with a girl you've never been with before, even if you're
a
porn
star?
When you
hear how many shoots this guy does, I think it's just like, next.
I still think the first one, like, wow, I haven't had that one. Cool.
I don't know.
I doubt it.
It's hard to get into the head of somebody that says, you know what I'm going to do someday?
Oh, all the time, dude, but you got to do it, man. I wouldn't be a pro, you know what I mean? It's part of the, it's not a dating service, it's work, man. You know, dude, I banged chicks that weren't the greatest, but hey, I mean, you know, not that I'm Robert Redford or frickin' Cary Grant, you know what I'm saying? You know, I mean, I love women, dude. I want to touch them and kiss them and, you know, squeeze them. They're pretty. And I get paid to do it, so I can't complain, you know?
But he is complaining.
Yeah.
How much does this guy get?
I would love to know how much these people get paid.
The disparity is huge. The girls get like thousands of dollars, and he gets like $16 and a pack of Skittles, and they're kicking the ass.
Right. So
get
why,
out.
Why does he just go to the sperm bank? It'd be easier, quicker.
And I get paid to do it, so I can't complain, you know?
How long have you been doing it?
Five and a half years, believe it or not. Yeah, already. Where does the time go, man?
In your pants, evidently.
Yeah, it goes quick, doesn't it? Time flies when you're having fun, I guess.
How many films have you done?
That's an excellent question. I'd have to say 500, 100 a year, maybe.
Isn't that insane?
Well, that's what's weird, too, is remember the girls had said that one of the girls had been in the business for, what, like a year, she said, and already she owned three houses. And here's Dino doing 100 movies a year, and he, like, gets to the shoot on the M11 city bus, you know? He did nothing.
I wonder if the same interview went down when he went home for Thanksgiving. So, what do you do for a living? Oh, I'm a porn star. Really? How many girls are here?
The thing that made the set even more awkward was the fact that one of the stars had a little crush on a certain somebody in this room. And they were doing still shots. And this is the weirdest. Like, they have guys with digital cameras that are doing all the shots for the outside of the DVD case.
Right.
And they actually, while they're shooting the film, they'll be like, cut. And then those guys will come in and shoot the pictures and then jump out. And then they start filming again. But so while they're doing the still shots, Mia Bang is screaming out Wayne's name and winking at him and saying, and jacking her butt up in the air and going, this one's for you, Big Wayne.
That was a very highlight of the night, without a doubt.
Dude, you should have seen Wayne when we left this place. Wayne gave her, he's like, oh, and then her butt in the air. And, oh, wow, did you see that one move? And they called it a reverse cowgirl. And that was just amazing. I'm going to go home and I'm just going to tear my wife up.
I left pretty high. That's all I know. And I'm looking to go back.
So I had to question her about, you know, why she had a crush on Wayne. And why is it, like, I love Wayne. He's, like, one of my greatest friends. But, I mean, Reed is much more attractive than us two. And how...
But I'm not the bad boy. Wayne's got like a beard down to his waist, and he looks like he would he's a strong, big guy.
Reed, didn't you get a text message from your lady that night saying that she was a little certain something going on? And
she was a little excited.
She was, because we were watching Wayne's homemade
porn. Has she ever gone to the website and seen a picture of Big Wayne?
Oh, she knows what you look like.
Oh, so she's been to the website and you haven't.
I've been to the website, but I also have our friend Brandon drew some fan art for the show, and that's up on my refrigerator, and she's like, is this what Wayne looks like?
No, I was...
You look like a pro wrestler, dude.
I just love that we got email from people and verbal notices that some people got a little excited during the show last week.
That's all on you.
I've been living like a newlywed this past 2 weeks. I gotta tell you, the action is flying.
I got an email from Wayne's girl the next day. She's like, I don't even want to go home. He's gonna tear me up.
You guys know you had visions. You know, it's
I was traumatized.
And come on, those girls made it look like every girl in the world should do that, and there's no problem to it at all. Am I right?
True.
They made it all look pretty simple, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, I don't want it coming my way. I know that. But they made it look like every girl in the world should be willing to do that.
Sure, girl on girl, whatever.
Yeah, no, I'm not talking girl on girl.
So here's Mia Bang.
Would one of you be wanting to stand in the corner like this? Like a spiritual...
That's the wrong clip. That's what him... That was the whole bit when Reed gets asked to do it, and Reed turned like bright red.
I didn't get asked.
Why did you say that's for Wayne, and then you stuck your ass up in the air?
That was for him. I wanted to show him. I told you I'd get naked for him. You know, I had to come in and make a little interruption. See, Dino right here, he's the one that invented the whole little elbow handshaking. Sense his elbow right here.
Yeah, we should talk about
What's
this.
What's that?
The porn stars don't shake hands, and you try to shake their hand, and they won't do it.
Okay, you know, I asked him about
germs.
That on the show. That's exactly what it was. But I asked him, I said I had read that, you know, the week before, that they don't shake hands because you don't know where your hands have been in the business. So all they do is tap elbows, sort of like chicken wings.
And chicken wings.
Well, you know how it is. And so I asked all three of them about it, and they were like, oh, you're stupid. I don't know what that is. And then now she comes out and says that Dino Bravo invented that.
Well, I mean, and that's...
I doubt it.
That's what they did. I tried to shake her hand and say, you know, good job. You did it.
High five.
Yeah. You know, wow.
That's how I'm shaking Wayne's hand from now on.
I was told I could put my hands anywhere.
Oh, wow.
But you were asking me now.
I don't know. Oh, the craziest thing that they were asking you to do.
Craziest thing that I've ever really asked to do. They put a prosthesis on me, a plastic thing, and called me Mangina. She, you know, I put on these pants, and we did like this little skit, and she's like, how come we've never done it before? I've known you all these years, you know, and it was like, all right, here I am a guy, and I had this thing on. It was called Mangina, and I don't know where it is or where you can find it. And, you know, it was funny, though.
That's got to be a little humiliating. Like, oh, I'm going to be a woman in this next film.
So then is that the big surprise?
Yeah, he got big money when he did that role, though.
Yeah,
right, exactly.
Right. He got like some, a Metro card.
Funny, though.
Ain't the craziest thing anybody's ever asked you?
I don't know. I have a lot of crazier stories as far as escorting go. I do that as well.
Did I mention that?
Just
Reed?
Throw that right on out there. Go ahead, Mia.
Guess what? I bang for money.
Mm.
My name is Mia Bang. Mia Bang you long time for $20.
Your stories as far as escorting go, I do that as well.
So you do both?
Yeah.
So how much to go with Wayne?
Well, Wayne gets a discount.
You saw him in action. You saw his video.
I sure did. He looks pretty good with his tongue skills and his finger skills, most definitely. I'm not sure. I'm sure we can work something out. I'm pretty nice.
$1.98 or kidding.
Dino Bravo's like $1.98.
Because that's all he has in his pocket, you know?
Exactly.
$1.98 or kidding.
I'll trade you some Pokemon cards.
Oh, yeah? Those are worth something, I heard.
Yeah, exactly.
A whole, like, 30 cents or something.
What about some tickets to a Knicks game or something? Or basketball, baseball, what are you a fan of?
Ballet.
So you would...
Is Dino
look like a cultured girl?
Yeah.
is Dino negotiating to get with Big Wayne himself? He's battling against her. And
that was a little weird. He was like, "How about some Knicks tickets?"
She's the porn star with the heart of gold. You know, she does this during the day, but at night she dreams of being a ballet dancer.
Of being a ballerina.
Yeah.
She sits there in the morning, taking her makeup off.
crying,
trying to get rid of the shame, looking at herself in the mirror, and she's got one of those little ballerina boxes that you wind up. And she,
one day I'll show them all. I'll be on the stage at Lincoln Center.
But tonight?
Yeah, right. Come on over here, Dino.
That's a blockbuster movie right there, boy.
Yeah. I think it's called Pretty Woman.
Ballet.
So you would bang Wayne for ballet tickets?
Mm-hmm, I sure would.
Does he have to go to the ballet with you?
No, he doesn't have to.
I was a little surprised.
See, now that's a slap in the face.
I'm not into ballet.
But wouldn't you want to escort the lady before it goes down?
Not really. No.
All right.
She's the escort.
Could be a little boring.
Okay. Yeah.
But she had some body, huh?
No, she did.
Yeah, actually, if you want to see these chicks, we have a picture. We were asked to. They were going at it on this couch, and then we say, "Hey guys, we got to leave because we got to catch a train so we get home before 4 a.m. And so they said, "Oh, come get a group picture." And so we get close to the couch, and Reed runs behind the couch.
Oh, I ain't sitting on that couch, man. And it was like, you know, that musical chairs game you play where, like, Wayne and Lazlow are the last men standing. And it's like, here, you guys have a
I was
seat.
The first guy there. I jumped on that couch.
Oh, right.
Couch.
That's right.
And threw those clothes away.
And then I was told you could put my hands anywhere I wanted, Ed. That's what I was told. I kept
by Dino.
No, not by Dino. No, that was by Haley.
Now, were you worried that maybe this photo end up on the back of the DVD box?
I did nothing wrong.
Yeah, it's we all did good. Nothing wrong.
We just sat there.
I'm coming back. Oh. I'm hoping my face ends up on a box.
But there's actually a picture that we got from the shoot, and I think Reed's face is still blushed red from when they asked him to be in the movie.
It was hot in there, man. You were under those lights.
It was under those lights.
I'm very fair.
He got sunburned.
Yeah.
But it's posted at lazlow.com if you want to go check that out.
Ballet with you.
No, he doesn't have to.
So when you're doing your scene tonight, could you maybe yell out Wayne, Big Wayne, oh yeah?
Oh, I sure can. I can yell out more than that.
She's going to yell it because I sure say hello. I'm Big Wayne, oh yeah?
Shut up, Dino Bravo.
What did that have to do with anything?
He definitely is jealous.
Is he crowding the microphone at this point, like trying to get out of it?
Yes.
I don't want my interview to be over.
Well, it's great to see. I was talking to him, and she came over and busted in and interrupted his little interview. So he was obviously a little upset. He kept trying to throw in little dumb one-liners.
Sorry, he'll get her back later.
So, but the best part of the evening and the last clip from Wayne and Reed and I attending a porn shoot was Reed was asked to star in the film.
Not exactly star.
I think you were getting credits.
All right.
Something's wrong with your mic.
Yeah.
I think you, did you hit it?
Did you unplug it?
I heard it clicked. You hit a button.
I'd ask you to come share mine, but who knows where your hands have been. Here, just rub elbows with me.
Would one of you be wanting to stand in the corner like this, like a Bertolt Brecht statement?
I think maybe Reed should stand in the corner. What would he do in the corner?
Just stand.
Put a dunce cap on him.
Just stand. And the bit would be that with all this kineticism, someone is thinking.
What?
And also, that's probably the first porno director to ever reference Bertolt Brecht. I went to college, and I have no idea what that means.
I thought Brecht was Hairspray.
No.
Did you say kineticism?
He's using big words, dude.
He was going to make a statement with one of us. And did you... okay, just in my defense, he said, would one of you be willing to stand in the corner and you throw me to the wolves?
I threw you under the bus.
You said under the bus that Dino was riding to get there.
That with all this kineticism, someone is thinking.
I don't know about what kineticism is, but there's a chick with her butt in the air.
Yeah, there is that. And it
break it down, Lazlow.
I know. I was like, what's weird is on the shoot, I have to say, Joe Gallant was a really nice guy. He was funny.
Cool.
Obviously intelligent.
Yep.
But he kept throwing out all these crazy, cinematic references. I'm like, dude, you're filming people banging. We're not going to, have... like some kind of Fellini film going on. Right.
Oh, there was a Fellini film. You just didn't watch it.
Yes, there was.
Okay.
I don't know about what kineticism is, but there's a chick with her butt in the air.
Yeah, there is that. And it's pretty, but it is.
So you want Reed to star in your performance? What would he do?
I think he should just walk through with a clipboard.
Walk through with a clipboard?
Yeah, yeah. Yes, sir.
You have to talk to my agent. Is that cool?
Okay.
Wayne, he wants me to ask you if it's okay to walk through with a clipboard. Yeah, the agent.
You got to negotiate for me, dude. You're my agent.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Get him in there, yes. Yeah.
I need foreign rights, Joe. I need something on the back end.
Yeah. I think you're going to get something on the back end.
Yeah. And not anything pleasant.
It's called Dino Bravo.
You should have just told him you didn't bring your Social Security card or passport.
I had mine.
And I do look young, so.
Ray's holding us up the whole time. Yeah. Me.
I never go without my passport anymore.
That's for sure. I'll carry it everywhere. You never know what porn's going down.
That's right.
Well, evidently, every night at Big Wayne's house.
Yeah, man. I'm living large.
Lots of kineticism in your house.
Yeah, I need foreign rights, Joe. I need something on the back end.
Yeah.
I'm in, dude. Hook him up. Okay, he already gave me the okay of what I could do.
What's that?
I might be in the corner shuffling the deck.
So we walk out of this, we have to run for our trains and stuff, and we get down the elevator, and Reed and Wayne and I look at each other, and we all just shake our heads and go, what
happened?
What just happened there? That was the weirdest thing ever.
Yeah.
And Wayne goes to me, because like we were in these director's chairs, and there was, like Wayne said, there was these other people. There was like a couch next to us, and so there was probably another 10 or 15
at least 10
people,
or 15 people,
there. And Wayne goes, did you see what the chick next to you was doing? And I said, dude, my jaw was on the floor the entire time. I did not look left or right. I didn't want to look at some, because I looked at this chick next to me for just a second. She was probably in her 40s.
Yeah.
I looked over at her, and she kind of gave me this creepy smile, and I was like,
like she wanted you?
I couldn't tell. And so then we get downstairs, and Wayne goes, did you see what the chick next to you was doing?
But it was everybody. When I got up at one point, and it was weird. I went to the bathroom, and I came back, and I was like behind the set now looking from the backside at everybody in the room and their faces. And this is what morally scarred me, is that there was a lot of, you know, people pleasuring themselves.
Yes.
And Lazlow's sitting right next to this one chick, you know, skirts hiked up.
She's blasting off, and I have no idea.
And now, at the start, I don't know what, I look at everybody now, and I wonder what goes on in their minds and their bedrooms.
I could just imagine people watching pornos, but getting turned on. Like, I would be afraid to go to the bathroom, like, it'd be filled. Like, that's an somebody's going to grab a girl and go, hey, me and you, wow, this is going on, because I'm turned on. Let's go.
Well, that's what my old lady's saying. If we go to one of these, we might have to go to the bathroom. I said, I think Joe wants us to stay in the middle of the room.
Right. I think
if I was him, I'd put cameras in the bathroom.
You might want to.
I think I've seen my one and only.
Really?
Yeah, I'm done with porn sets.
I got to say, if Joe's listening, I need to get invited to one of those real explosive shots, if you know what I'm saying, Joe.
lots of air freshener. That's no joke.
Yeah, he's a big fan of incense.
But you know what was weird about all those people sitting around the set, and I guess this is true for us too, but we had no idea why they were there. They weren't part of the crew, and it was just like, you know, all of a sudden, 20 minutes into the thing, the buzzer rings, and up comes this like 50-year-old bearded guy who just sits down, and you're like, who are you?
You got to think about it. If you were a porn director or you knew somebody who was, wouldn't you parlay that into, like, dude, my buddy's having a porn shoot tomorrow. You want to go? $20
Exactly.
You're in between. You bring the beer? That's a Friday night right there, boy.
Yeah. In this case,
Sunday. I got to say, I think we left early. I think there's a lot more that happened after we left, Ed. I think it got crazy. I think if we had $20 in our pocket, we might have been in the video.
Or two ballet tickets, apparently.
Or two, right?
You've been in the house.
And it was a nice house.
I got two ballet tickets and a candy bar. Things are pretty lucrative right now.
Coming up on the Lazlow Show, Jim Florentine has indicated that he's going to be coming by. He's been shooting segments for Comedy Central, which I've been going and checking out. I guess he just did another Meet the Creeps.
Meet the Creeps 2.
And
bring me a pizza, Jim. I'm hungry. Thanks.
When he calls you on the phone, he's so weird on the phone.
He's normal. That's what's weird about him. He is so funny. And the DVDs for stand-up, when he's on the radio, but when he's not, he's just like, he's the nicest, normal guy.
But he's very dry.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, hey, it's Jim.
My accountant?
I'm like, hey, you want to come on the show on Sunday? Yeah, cool.
What do you want him to do? That's what comedians, everyone always thinks that they're all wacky all the time. It's like, oh, tell us a joke.
They get
tired of that.
He called me once on the hotline at work, and not to be on the air, he was just calling in to check in. I think he was going to do an appearance the following week, and we pick up. We didn't know it was him, so we're doing one of his bits to him, not knowing it's him. Like, hey, he goes, hey, is that there? Like, yeah, hold on, let me get my brother. Yeah, hi, this is... Is that there? Yeah, hold on. Let me get my brother. We just kept doing that, and we finally realized it's him. Like, oh, that's not good when we're ripping off your bit in front of you.
Right. Exactly. This is the Lazlow Show. We're going to take a quick break. Come back with Jim Florentine at some point. Plus, information about Reed Stalker, who is now calling your home.
If we can get him on the line, we'll see.
He's got your home number?
It ain't Dino Bravo, is it?
They really need to do a new one of those. It says great rock period, and then we talk all hour.
I know. When I'm at my house and I hear that sound, it gives me flashbacks. I'm like, oh,
big. Listen to the station, Reed. You actually listen
for the music.
No, I don't.
No,
that was a lie.
I'm not saying Reed. has been labeled the producer of this show, and I asked him. We did a best of show last week because I was up in Canada snowboarding at Whistler.
Yeah, all right.
I called Cousin Ed every day, and I was like, "Dude, the powder."
I'm working. He's like, "I'm at the top of Whistler right now. Just got off the Wizard lift. Thanks." Okay, go. No, what hurt the most, we're like, yeah, I'm in Vancouver right now. We just stopped by, the jukebox where we buy the weed.
I love the jukebox. It's at the...
Was it really the same guy from like three years ago?
The same guy. You go up to the jukebox and he's like, what can I get you? A little Green Day?
Right.
Green grass and high tides for real.
Oh my God, dude. This stuff was stanky.
That was the first time your girl had to BC, was it?
It's the first time she's been to Vancouver.
Yeah.
So that whole area of Little Amsterdam, it's just so weird. You walk into places and people are just firing up. It's very bizarre.
The Blunt Brothers store really burned down?
Yeah, it burned down, and all the
what's there? Just nothing?
No, they moved into the Amsterdam Cafe next door, so it's like really crowded, and it's really stinks of weed.
Because it burned down next door.
Yeah. With somebody like, must have left a roach laying on some newspapers or something.
Those are some happy firemen.
I'm sure.
Yeah, I'm sure they had the grow lights overheated in the basement. But I said to Reed, I'm like, we're going to do a best of. They screwed it up and lost the CDs when we did our best of before. And we took very good care. We recorded like new intros. We did all this stuff. And I'm like, Reed, if you could just check and make sure that it's running. If not, give me a call. Reed didn't even listen. Doesn't care.
He had the day off.
Exactly. Well, come on. It was Thanksgiving.
It wasn't Thanksgiving.
Sunday.
Thanksgiving
Sunday.
Weekend.
Thanksgiving. Exactly.
Thank you. It's a holiday weekend.
That's right.
Everybody else is enjoying 3 or 4 days off.
Well,
why can't we?
While I was at the top of,
how many times you got to rub this in my face?
The Glacier Express in Blackcomb.
Did you break any legs or thumbs while you're up there?
I rented a board and turned it into a cheese grater because there's a lot of rocks still showing because there's not a ton of snow on the ground. But there's a lot of fresh powder, but it's not a base built real thick yet, and I rented this board and got the $3 damage waiver, and they're just stripes from rocks down the middle of it, just housed it.
You know why he didn't take me this time? Because every time we go, I end up in the hospital somehow.
Yeah, the last time...
We know exactly where that place is.
The last time...
I got amnesia, broken ligaments, thumb, whatever it takes.
The best snowboarding story ever. Cousin Ed knocked himself out so bad that he had no idea that he was on the radio. And his wife told him, what happened? You were in a snowboarding accident. And then, he's talking. He's like, well, what do I do for...
No, she was bitchy. You better get your crap together because you have a job in New York. In 2 weeks, you start. Like, really, what'd I do? You're on the radio. Wow. That sounds like fun. I'm like, am I any good? She goes, you got a job in New York. It's a syndicated show. I'm like, cool. But what do I do when I get up there? That mic turns on. I'm like, oh. Wow. I don't know how I got this job.
Right.
Did you know who your wife was?
No.
Did she have to introduce herself?
I knew she was somebody important in my life, but she meant something, but that was really it. And then she got mad at that, too.
Oh.
The nurse comes in, she's like, what's your name? I'm like, I don't know. She's like, all right, your name's Ed, my name's Mary, I'll be back. She comes back 5 minutes later, she goes, what's your name? I'm like, I don't know.
But when you saw your wife, were you like, yes? Or were you like, could have done better?
I really wasn't even, at that point, you're not even thinking about that. You're like, uh-oh, mm-hmm. What if nothing ever comes back? Well, still, I got her, I guess, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, but
and a job in New York.
Here I am, the one in pain with no memory, and she was not enjoying it at all. Ugh.
And so...
Ex-wife.
Yet to this day... He's not bitter. To this day, Cousin Ed, he and I will be snowboarding together, and both of us are... Like, we'll go to the French Alps and be going through stuff where there's avalanches. We'll go to Whistler and be on the back of this glacier. And neither of us are wearing helmets. He nearly killed himself. Still no helmet. And, the last time he and I went to Whistler, he wiped out bad on the glacier and ended up in the hospital.
Yeah, ripped the ligaments off of my thumb. And then you're halfway up the mountain. It's still another hour down. And you're like, and I took my glove off like a dummy because now my thumb swelled up and I couldn't put my glove back on. So the whole way down, you're just like one-handed. Please don't fall again.
And I was hanging out with Cousin Ed's brother, who's named Brother Ed, in Seattle last week.
Does he use the brother moniker when he introduces himself?
Is he a Jesuit priest? I mean,
for some reason,
Brother Ed.
Cousin Ed's redneck family named them both Ed.
Like George Foreman.
But he was talking about how humiliating it was that he had to dress you Because your arm was all screwed up. He had to dress you. Uh-huh. And I hear that he had to help you in the bathroom, too.
He did not.
Well, you didn't have your memory. Someone had to help you.
No, this is a different accident.
Yeah, I should have played that one off my wife.
Oh, that would have been great.
I forget what to do.
Oh, dude, how great would that be?
I distinctly remember you're supposed to shake it at the end. No, keep shaking.
No, I think it'd be great for like one of Florentine's Meet the Creeps things is you find somebody with amnesia and you go in and you're like, so here's the deal, dude. You are gay.
Yes. I'm your lover.
I'm your lover and you are so well endowed. And we have a little cat, and I've got AIDS. And
you probably do, too.
And you probably do, too. So not only can you not remember anything, you're going to die. All right. I ought to get some activists right after this.
In honor of World AIDS Day this week, Lazlow's AIDS humor.
Hey, wait. Here's something funny that's not. You brought that up. National Peanut Butter Month just ended. It was November was National Peanut Butter.
Oh, I forgot to celebrate.
See, yeah, I'm obsessed with peanut butter. I got like 8 different kinds in my house all at one time. But I read this in the paper. This is the story comes in the last day of November. A 15-year-old girl with a peanut allergy died after kissing her boyfriend.
Oh, yes, I heard.
Who had just
that.
Eaten a peanut butter snack. Now, I don't know why, but that's funny.
Yes, no, it is funny.
You know, death is normally not funny, but there's something.
Oh,
funny
yes,
about
it is, dude.
Well, my question was: is that an open mouth kiss, or was it like a grandma kiss? You know, how much peanut butter could you have in your mouth to transfer in a grandma kiss?
He could have been murder. He probably put a whole spoonful. Come here, baby.
Oh yes,
and then just like laid it on her.
Exactly,
dude. You know, this
off his girlfriend.
This is how weak we have become as a people. When peanut butter kills you. When you can't have peanuts on a plane because somebody in the back who has grown up in some sterile house where people will be Swiffering and everything and they got no, like, you know, immune system, and you open some peanuts and they're back there.
See, I'm looking at how dastardly her 15-year-old boyfriend was. That guy, 15 years old, he's smart. He's like, I know how to get rid of her.
Yeah.
Well, shoot the parents and get on the road.
But it's gone too far. You know, here I am. As I do every week, eating my Three Musketeers.
Hey, if you're into that, whatever.
Yeah, it means something different this week.
Yes, exactly. So you're eating it again, huh?
It means a candy bar. And you know, they have to put a warning on everything. And this says, right at the very, in very small print, you know, allergy information, warning, may contain peanuts. No, it doesn't. That's a Snickers. This is a Three Musketeers.
No,
it does not contain peanuts.
It may have been peanut oil, though.
You know,
wait. Why does it say May? Don't you think they would know that if they made it?
No, because that's just that just gets them out of any sort of claim that anyone can bring against them. Well, we told you it may contain peanuts.
Well, I mean,
that's what I'm saying, or it may be like processed in a plant next door to something that does peanuts. Well, crazy, Wayne.
It sounds crazy.
The whole lawsuit culture with like there's guys that have been Santa Claus in malls and stuff for 30, 40 years are now quitting because some of them have to get insurance. Because parents are suing the Santas
for touching the kids.
Well, just because
where the kid cries, like
there's this is how wussy parents have become, and why I can't stand breeders because they think the
breeders.
Whole world has to revolve around.
He's a breeder.
I know, that's a very gay term. God, why don't I just ride my scooter down to Chelsea and do some flower shopping?
Bitter much?
But no, I mean, like there's all these. There was this article that I was reading about how all these guys who normally do Santa stuff are stopping because there's all these rules now. They can't hand out lollipops. They can't pat children on the head because of religious beliefs.
Mm-hmm.
What? Is there some religious belief?
They want to knock off the yarmulke, but then they would be on Santa's lap anyway.
I always thought that was like a that a boy.
they can't put children on their laps unless they get permission from parents. And they can't have photographs taken with youngsters unless their hands are in full view.
Oh, come on.
Why don't they just have a big sign? Like when you go to a mall and they're shooting for a TV show, there's just a big sign there. And it says, you know, your kid's going to sit on Santa's lap.
Right.
And maybe
touch. That's why you're in line anyway.
Some Santas have been asked not to go around saying ho, ho, ho because they may frighten children.
Mom, he called you a hoe when I was on his lap.
This one guy has been a Santa for 41 years, and he finally quit. He said the pressure of being politically correct has become too much and says it's his last year. He's done. They also have to hire somebody to watch and be a witness so that if a parent goes, you made my kid cry, I'm going to sue you.
Nice. Yeah, you psychologically traumatized my kid.
Right. That's great. They have to post a sign that it says, warning, Santa may contain peanuts. You know, it's like,
Santa may drop a Three Musketeers.
Santa may fondle your child. Warning.
Yeah, exactly.
We warned you.
Yeah, that's
best
pretty...
movie to watch, Bad or Santa. That's my favorite. You know who I had on my show this week is the guy from A Christmas Story. Remember the kid who licked the pole?
Oh, yeah?
He's a porn star now. I wasn't allowed to bring that up, though.
Come on.
I swear to God. His
Are
name
you
was,
serious?
When you say licked the pole, you have to verify what
his,
he was.
His name was Scott Schwartz in the movie. You never seen Christmas Story?
No.
The old one with Ralphie?
Dude, I was singing
right,
the Peanuts.
Star Wars,
I was singing the Peanuts theme earlier, and he was like, "What's that?" I'm like, "Did you live in a cardboard box?"
There was a station.
And the answer was yes.
There was a radio station in Philadelphia today. They actually played that part of their Christmas music. It was the Peanuts theme. Anyway, this guy Scott Schwartz, he's in the movie Christmas Story, and then part of the deal, he's like out in the schoolyard, and it's freezing and it's snowing out, and they dare him to like stick his tongue on the pole. And then they double dog dare him and triple dog dare him, and he sticks his tongue on there. And it, you know, because of the coldness, his tongue gets stuck.
Froze,
right. So he's telling us the whole story. And apparently, when they shot the movie, there was a metal pole, but they had a little plastic one inside of it, and it had a suction cup. And he stuck his tongue there, and he used a vacuum to hold his tongue there. Mm-hmm. And as soon as his tongue got stuck, they broke for lunch and left him there for a half hour, 20 below. But eventually, yes, the guy, he comes in because they're doing a big celebrity showing down in Philadelphia this like past weekend, and all the stars in the movie were going
to
be there.
And you weren't allowed to mention that he's a porn star?
Because they're doing the showing, obviously, is a Christmas story, so it's a family-oriented event, and they were having it at a high school, so they're like, don't bring up the porn part.
I would have.
And, of course, our spokesmodel, Tanya, calls in from Florida. Yeah, Scott Schwartz is in the studio. The guy who's in the porno from A Christmas Story?
Excellent.
Yeah, we're not supposed to mention that dumb broad.
She is a dumb broad.
Right. Is he licking any other poles?
Why do you have this chick on your show? She's just a dingy girl.
Because she has attitude. She doesn't care. She doesn't care that she's dumb. She doesn't care that she's materialistic and shallow. What did she say the other day when I think she was on the phone with us? That she broke up with a guy. She dated a guy with Tourette's in high school. Didn't break up with him because he had Tourette's. Broke up with the guy because he didn't make the football team.
That's shallow.
Marsha.
Yeah, you didn't make the football team? You're done.
What does she look like, Ed?
She's pretty hot.
She's hot.
Yeah, but see, what's the point of having a hot girl? It's radio, you know? Just get somebody who's smart.
I mean, most of the good radio...
No, Ed needs someone hot to work with.
No, not anymore. In this day and age, you can't just act like she's hot because there's too much media. You have to have a website, and people go on, they see what she looks like, and then you go to events, and she hands out her little 8x10s, and it's sad. I have a little square, like 4x6 black and white photo. She has like 8 different 8x10 colors. Here you go.
That's so weird. A station with a spokesmodel.
She does nothing.
Wait, why do you have headshots?
Yeah.
So when you go out and do public appearances, I actually don't break them out. Like, usually when you go to a public appearance, the promotional team will set them out on the table. You know, some people line up and get your autograph. I take mine and hide them. Like, look, if they want my autograph, they'll ask for it. I'm not going to go, here's my pictures. Do you want my autograph?
When Ed first started working in New York and people would come up and ask for his autograph, he'd ask for their autograph back.
Yeah. Taught him that we're equal.
That reminds me... I was hanging out with your brother and his wife, and I found a little bit of information on you that I did not know about your. Evidently have a little conviction regarding exposure of a certain body part in public.
Which part?
You don't even remember. Your brother.
I don't know if I trust you, or this is just a made up story that my brother is using to get back at me.
Your brother's wife.
Right.
Was evidently going to jury duty, and they said, "Has anybody in your family been arrested?"
Oh, okay. And that'd be me.
She said, yes.
More than once.
My brother-in-law is on the radio, but he was arrested for exposing his buttocks.
Indecent exposure in high school, yeah.
And
drunk in public, indecent exposure, I don't know what else.
And this is what came back to me. When I first moved to New York from a rock station in the Midwest, and Cousin Ed moved from a rock station in Virginia, and... We had just become friends, our eyes met, that kind of thing. And he was doing his night show, and I was coming on and hanging out with him. But you and I went to weedy smoking thing. Oh, look who it is, Jim Florentine.
Hey, Jim, what's up?
All right.
Why don't you talk to him on the phone, Reed?
All right.
Finish your little story. I know where you're going with this.
Do you want the card, dude?
Hello. He's not there.
He's not there.
I'll go get him now.
You're going to need the card.
Yeah.
All right.
So I want you to finish. I want to tell the drunken story because I know what happened there. But my brother tried to tell me this one that you're about to tell, and I don't think it happened.
No, here's what
happened. I don't remember.
Or maybe because you're both named Ed,
maybe it was him.
Exactly.
Maybe Lazlow got
you
confused.
And I were driving. You and I were driving to some Earth Day thing.
Earth Day.
And
And there was
you want to take that?
Somebody that there was somebody that like cut you off or cut, no, it cut me off and I was driving.
All right, so you're driving.
And you in the car, I'd only known you like 2-3 weeks. You hiked your pants down and turned around and stuck your ass against my window at this other driver.
See, now here's where I'm going to pick this story apart, as would the defendant in a court of law. Have you ever been in the car with Lazlow Wayne?
Yes.
So you know how he drives.
Yeah.
Okay. So if a guy cuts him off, how do I pull my pants down and moon that guy when he's obviously in front of us? Because Lazlow is not going to go above the speed limit and catch up to this guy.
Yeah.
So I your story just falls
about,
apart.
Dude,
you know, it's 55, you go 50.
He That's, stops at green lights.
I call him. I know. I'll call him on the air, and he'll be in the car and go, dude, I got to talk on the phone.
On the phone.
He goes, it's against the law. I'm like, so smoking weed.
But the problem is maybe I've smoked, and that's the reason I'm a little paranoid.
That's right. So there's no way I pull my pants down and...
You sure?
There does seem to be a little bit in the defense's
the other
defense.
One, and look, so I don't have an obsession with showing my buttocks. It was twice, obviously.
Yeah,
and
but
the,
dude,
the first time was high school, and I was drunk, and it was a whole restaurant of people.
But I mean, do you have Wayne? Do you have any friends that moon? I mean, that is so.
Everybody's mooned. That,
sure,
that's like. So,
have you ever mooned anybody, Florentine? See, mooning is it's a guy thing. He's on my case because I showed my buttocks.
Dude, that is
not right now.
That is so 1970s to moon people.
It was the 1970s when I did.
No, you did it in 95 when you and I first hung out. He was mooning a driver in another
when
car.
When was the last time you mooned somebody?
I mooned my grandmother last week. No, but Ozzy just moved. Osborne just moved.
See?
Moved, like the Queen or something like that over in England.
Recently?
Yeah, because they were at the Hall of Fame Awards or something like that over there.
I didn't read that one.
Yeah, something. Yeah, he mooned everybody because the crowd was just sitting there in tuxedos.
See, apparently I'm bringing
his
it
pants
back.
Down.
Oh, you're bringing it back.
Even Ozzy's taking after me.
Yeah, right.
He'll never be in the car with you, though.
Right, but except he probably has the same memory capacity.
He does.
As you.
My memory sucks. Well, I don't remember that at all.
Might have something to do with the fact that you got hit on the head at high speed while snowboarding,
or what we had at Earth Day when we got there.
Correct. So we should mention real quick, Jim Florentine in studio. Last time you hung out here, the Lazlow Show is episode 4. We're now on 21, and you were on the show right before Wayne joined the show.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Have you guys ever seen each other?
No, I'm nervous to meet him. Because I didn't think there was a bigger creep out there than me.
Thank you.
No problem. I mean that from the bottom of my heart, in a good way. No, when I heard his stuff, I was like, this guy's going to be... How is this guy not have his own show?
Well, he pretty much does.
I'm putting it all in your hands.
I'm telling you, man. How does he not have his own sitcom?
He does. It's called The Lazlow Show.
He does. And you see my job is I turn the mics on right here.
But like my name is... You know, my name is Earl Show. Just have him do all that stuff.
I'm realizing I have a lot of people to go back to apologize to.
Exactly. Half of them are probably dead anyway.
Couple.
It's all hookers
sure.
and drug addicts, right?
Couple.
Crack houses.
Yeah,
they're not going
to
hear
who
us.
Would you knock on a few car windows to get them.
Who would you apologize to?
There's some people that I've swindled, I'm sure. That
Maybe the girl who you showed complete strangers a videotape last show.
Yeah,
you
she might be owed an apology, but...
What if she's listening right now and actually eventually puts two and two together?
It's all good.
She won't care.
I don't think so. Joe was very complimentary of her. So.
Yeah.
Oh, she was a hottie?
She was good looking.
No matter how hot she was, I wouldn't want to see it because it's Wayne. You still got to look at
him,
right?
Yeah, it's weird seeing your friend bang.
Yeah, but what's more weird is you asking if you're going to see my junk the night before.
I had to know.
Yeah,
he wanted to know if he should bring hand cream or not.
Exactly.
It's one thing when you're watching a porn, there's a guy in it, but when the guy in it is your friend, no.
Well.
I've done that before. I tape recorded this girl, and I told her, and afterwards, I go, we'll erase it. We'll watch her erase it.
No, no.
When she went in the bathroom, I switched the tape. Like, oh, man,
I
didn't
love
come
this
out.
Guy.
And then, and as
you
soon as she left, I called all my friends up. They brought over a keg, and we watched it for hours. It was beautiful.
How long was it? Because Wayne's tape was like 3 hours, and he edited it down.
Wow. Yeah. Wayne. Big Wayne. No wonder that girl was impressed and liked it.
Mine was a motion picture.
Mine was 10 minutes, and I went twice.
I got to say, they watched 27 minutes, and I didn't go once.
Yeah,
really?
Yes. I had good stamina.
Well, I've never been high on crack when I had sex.
I wasn't into the crack just yet. This was all just weed-induced.
Oh, it was just weed.
Jim had to loop his tape to impress his friends.
So does your girlfriend listen to this show, or is she still around?
No, she doesn't listen.
Okay, good.
She doesn't care, though. She's whatever. She's all good.
Okay.
Yeah, have you seen Meet the Creeps? I don't think it matters. You can do whatever you want.
No, I haven't. That's the
I brought her with me.
That's excellent. You know, I was watching some of your clips on Comedy Central, and then the website stopped working for me.
Yeah, I don't know what's going on with
that. Isn't that weird? Am I the only one that's complaining about that?
No, it's crashed all the time.
But so you're filming segments just for Comedy Central?
Just for Comedy Central. We have one on our own coming out that's, you know, way out there. That could never be on, even on the internet.
Is that that?
Really?
Yeah.
Is that the Motherlode thing?
Yeah, the Motherlode thing, yeah.
I saw promos for that this past weekend.
Yeah. So we do stuff on there. We got to, you know, clean it up a little bit because kids could even be on the internet or whatever. But
really?
Our own stuff is out there and hardcore.
Okay, and well, I shouldn't even ask you about what can't be on television, because it can't be on television. It certainly can't be on radio. But have you filmed the abortion clinic?
Oh, yeah, we got that's going to be on the DVD, yeah. We didn't even pitch that idea to Comedy Central. Messing with people outside of an abortion clinic. We had a feeling they would say no.
You say abortion, nope, next.
Yeah, you don't even bring that up. Really? We tried to bring up some gay stuff, and they didn't go for it either.
I've got a great idea for you that we just came up with. You find somebody that's just got amnesia, and you go in and convince them that you're their boyfriend, and convince them that they're gay.
How do I find someone that has amnesia?
I don't know. There's
got to be a hospital.
There's got to be an amnesia support group somewhere.
Why don't you just knock somebody over the head?
That's true. Someone just got a concussion.
Yeah. Hey, Ed, watch out for that fallen bookshelf.
Right, that's an idea. I'm going to be gay in a week, aren't I?
Yes.
What's funny is the guy buys into it. Wow, I'm gay.
Exactly.
I'm open with that. That's cool.
Yeah. Then you come to and you're traumatized.
Yeah, what happens if you convince the guy that you're gay and you're his boyfriend and he believes it and goes into it? And then you have, like, how far do you take the joke at that point?
All the way.
You probably have to make out what I'm doing. So I'm not doing that bit.
Yeah. You draw the line.
Big Wayne, you want to be able to meet the creep
Jim,
free?
You never spent the night in the joint, huh?
No, never.
No? That close. Might be offered to you sometimes.
Yeah, no, definitely close, but no.
You can shoot that one at Pickle Park.
I've been drinking and driving for 23 years now. Never got caught.
That's amazing.
Never spent a night in the joint.
Wait, who was the one in Meet the Creeps where you went and rented the car, or went to go used car place?
Yeah, I went to check out a used car, and I cracked a beer open with the guy in the car while I was driving. He's like, is that a beer? I'm like, yeah, I'm thirsty. He's like, you can't drink. I'm like, yeah, there's no cops around. I'll be all right.
I'll drink it before they pull me over.
Wait, and then somebody sparked up a joint. You're like, hey, you want to hit? No.
Then I lit up a joint. I'm like, you want to hit? He's like, no, man, I'll smoke that. And I'm blowing a smoke in the guy's face.
The whole time he's driving?
Yeah.
Oh, that's great.
And I'm all over the road. I'm like, whoa. He's like, easy.
That's great.
That's amazing. Dude, I just rented the worst car ever in Seattle from Enterprise. This car, like, the engine light went on about 10 minutes after I drove off the lot. The windshield wiper fluid didn't work, and I'm driving in, like, snow and have to, like, I've got the gallon of windshield wiper fluid, and as I'm driving down the highway in snow,
reaching out
and throwing it on the windshield. It was a scene, dude. I was ready to drive it. And see, I have a problem with rental cars because I wreck them.
Was this before or after you stopped at Blunt Brothers?
Before, during, after. It was a mess, dude. I wreck rental cars. I've already, like, seriously damaged, too.
I rented one in Portugal, and I just put regular. Over there, they have regular gas. Remember
with
the old
lead
school?
In it?
Yes. And I didn't know. I pulled out. It was gas. I filled it up. Like 100 yards from, you know, the return.
Boom.
And just dies. I was like, I'm going to miss my plane, dude. Here's the car. See you later. I just left it there. Jumped on the plane and took off. I don't know who got the bill.
That's beautiful.
So,
yeah, but they charge a credit card, though, right? I mean, if you mess up a rent a car.
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And you don't care about that.
Well, yeah, I care about it, but, you know.
I got to be careful. I only have a $250 limit. I'm mine.
You rent a Yugo.
Yeah.
So but in this video, you didn't end up wrecking the car.
No, I wasn't going to do that. No, but, the guy was all, he was annoyed. I'm driving one of his cars, drinking a beer and smoking a joint.
He's off like, the lot. Just, so this is off the lot. This is like someone's house you went to.
Yeah, okay. It was off the lot, and then he, came in the car with me.
No, was the joint real or?
Yeah, please, you gotta do. I don't even smoke, but I did it for the bit. You gotta, you know what I mean?
That's what I say.
I got it. Yeah.
Officer, I don't really get high. I'm doing this just for the DVD. Okay?
Yeah, it's just for the DVD. You know what I mean?
That's what Wayne tells his family that listens to this show. He's like, I really don't blow through an ounce every 4 days.
Sometimes 2 days, Jim.
It's all for show.
Depends on what's going on.
So you're telling me that your voice is not from smoking cigarettes or weed or anything?
No, I smoked for like 5 years. No, I sounded like this when I was 14. It was embarrassing in school, everyone in the hallway would come down and, hey, say something. There'd be like nine people. I go, what? They're like, ah, they'll be laughing at me. But it was great because I would call all my friends out of school, pretending them their dad. I'm like, Mr. Bondi, this is Mr. Bondi. Tony can't come in today. You know what I mean? Like, and meanwhile, we just hang out, drink beers, play cards. We were like 12 years old. We'd have pots for like $500 at 12 years old. And we have to steal our parents' stuff to pay them off. Like a Playboy was worth like $20. Because our parents had, you know, we had Playboys laying around or food or whatever. Like that's how we paid off. We were just delinquents and derelicts at 12 years old.
I love now that there's teachers that are probably fans of yours going, wait a minute, that voice sounds familiar.
I'm sure.
It was Mr. Bonte.
Yeah, because one of my teachers wound up, she was a bartender at the local bar where I grew up in Old Bridge. And, she's like, afterwards, she's like, oh, you're doing good for yourself. You're a comedian, all this stuff. I go, yeah. She goes, good. You turned your life around because you were crazy when you were a kid. I go, yeah, man. I go, barely even drink anymore, right? Meanwhile, like, this fat girl came in. She goes, hey, you want to go smoke a joint in the car? I go, okay. So I go out in the parking lot. I'm in the car smoking a joint with this girl. And the teacher comes out. She's like, what a scumbag you are. You lied to me. I'm like, look, I'm trying to get laid here. It's Tubby Tuesday.
And then you left her an Upper Decker in the bathroom.
So,
exactly.
So people, your family proud of you?
Yeah, my brothers just can't believe I do this for a living. They're like, I can't believe this is what you do for a living and
they're
get
jealous.
Paid. Yeah, definitely.
My mom went into a video game store somewhere in Texas just to see what the box of GTA looked like. And she was talking to the guy behind the counter and was like, yeah, you know, my son worked on this. And the guy was like, do you know really what the game's about? And she's like, no. Okie dokie. The weirdest story was I had a chick do a VO for one of the hookers in the game, you know, that you can pick up or whatever. And she was, it went to a Christmas, and I guess somebody got a hold of the game, and her nephew was there, and the mom's like, oh, we should have the nephew play the game and go pick up Maria.
Oh, boy.
So it's like the kid's picking up.
How old was he?
Not old enough to be playing the game. You got to be 18. You know what I mean? But she goes, it was so creepy because once, you know, the hooker gets in the car, mm-hmm. you know, they start banging. She's like, so it's like I was sleeping with one of my family.
I was playing the PSP version at work the other day and the older, like, business manager's like, what's that? And she loves technology. She has a Game Boy. And she's like, oh, this is cool. What game is it? I'm like, all right, here's what you do. Now run that guy over, steal that car, and I'll pick up this hooker. She's like, get this away from me. She's like, I know I'm in the game too. And you're proud of this? Out of my office.
That's great. Yeah, it's like when you remember when you used to go on vacation with your friends and your mom wanted to see your pictures when you came back. You could only show like 2 out of 40.
Right.
Yeah, the rest didn't come out. I mean, the rest of everyone else is throwing up. The people are naked.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Always. Yeah, and I don't know what happened with the camera. Something's wrong with the camera.
What's that strange vase in the corner? That's bong.
Why is there a mirror on top of the dresser?
Why does the
why do you have baby powder on the mirror?
Why does the chick look like the missing chick from Aruba? Nothing?
No, she's hot.
The missing chick from Aruba. Dr. Phil is still looking for her.
I know. We wanted to give you that awkward silence to make you feel bad.
I watched this whole Dr. Phil episode. I got to say, I was just... And he's on there saying, no American should travel to Aruba. Da-da-da. You know, it's a terrible... It's like, what do you expect when you go outside of the country and you go to, like, resort destinations, whether it's Jamaica or Central America or Aruba? Dude, it's not Florida. You know, like, nasty stuff goes down there. So you got to, like, you know, don't leave your drink out. You know, pay attention to your drink because somebody's going to throw a Mickey in it or something like that. You know, make sure you negotiate for the weed because they always start high, you know, and you offer half.
Watch for the switcheroo.
What's the switcheroo?
That's when they, you know, show you the weed. It looks really good weed. And then when you go to pay for it, you're pulling your money out. They switch it with something like parsley. Not good.
Has that happened to you?
Yeah. That was my senior class trip in high school.
I was at a dead show where a buddy of mine bought a huge bag of basically grocery store mushrooms. I was like, as I looked at him, I was like, dude, are you making a salad? You're an idiot. And he kept eating them and getting sadder and sadder. I'm like, I was like, dude, you know.
Might as well eat them at that point.
Exactly.
You paid for them.
Right.
Coming up on the big show, we've got a little bit of news about what's going on with the show, or not going on, for that matter. Got a little call up in Canada, Reed. Our esteemed boss man, Robert Cross, has moved on to another company that broadcasts from devices in space. And so we have no idea how much longer we're going to be around.
He's working with the space shuttle, is he?
Yes, exactly.
Broadcasting to four astronauts.
So he's going to be up there at the Russian space station, helping them cobble together pieces and whittle controls. So, yeah, Rob Cross has left K-Rock. So we don't even know who our boss is now. And we don't know if the show's going to keep going.
But they're going to all talk, though, right? So your show fits in.
Well, yeah.
But we don't know yet.
We don't know yet, you see. They wanted us to maybe do a full-time show overnight, but Wayne turned it down.
Thanks, Wayne.
Wasn't lucrative enough for me.
No.
Unfortunately, Wayne could make more money as a carpenter than in radio.
Yeah,
so
come January 1st, I'll take anything. I can bang a nail.
Yeah, so but you can always stay informed about what's going on, and plus you can listen to all the past shows. The website's lazlow.com. So what are you, you're filming some new segments for the Comedy Central deal, or
yeah, we're doing new segments and finishing up on a DVD.
You do one a week, or
usually one a week.
That's
yeah,
crazy. Dude.
I know. We produce it. We edit it. We just give them the idea. They approve it. Once they approve it, we're all on our own. So we got an editor. We got a camera guys and all that stuff.
Yeah,
so.
Patton Oswalt told me that, you know, they were doing that Comedians of Comedy thing for Comedy Central, and they said that they had a lot of, they got in a little bit of trouble with Comedy Central.
We haven't gotten in trouble with them yet. They pretty much leave us alone, which is great. You know, they just, you know, we just give them a cut of it every Monday, you know, a new bit or whatever. We go out and shoot it. They say, look, that's too rough. Take that out. Standards and practices is always, you know, we kind of know at this point what we could do and what we can't do.
Is it easier for you now as opposed to, you know, when you're doing the guerrilla stuff with Meet the Creeps? Because now you got people helping you.
No, because what happens with Comedy Central, you have to get like a location release. Like if we go into a CVS and mess with people, we have to get a release before we go in there, or they have to sign. If it's a corporate place, they're not going to let us sign. They're obviously not going to do
it.
Takes
the improv away from it.
Because my brother-in-law runs a Bennigan's, a Ruby Tuesdays or whatever, and I wanted to go in there, me and my buddy Don Jameson, fill out a job application, and as we're in there, crack open 40s, put a porno on and stuff on a laptop and stuff like that, and he's like, I can't even ask corporate about that. I'm like, come on, dude. So I found a dog training center my uncle owns. So we're filling out a job application. We crack open 40s, we start drinking them, the woman's freaking out. And then my buddy's like, I got to get my address on my laptop for my old job. And he opens his laptop, and there's a porno playing. And we just let it play as we're filling out. The woman is so uncomfortable. And I'm asking, so do I have to put the college down? Why this porno's just,
It should have been a bestiality porn.
And then I just started burping until she threw me out.
Really?
Yeah.
That's great. And the abortion clinic thing, how have you not gotten arrested?
It's been close. There's stuff pending, but so far nothing yet.
There's stuff pending.
I'm surprised because there are cops outside the abortion clinic, and there's security guards and their escorts. You know, they bring the people in and stuff like that. But they're really not that crazy, the abortion people. I guess you see it on the news, but they're pretty mellow. They try to talk you out of it. They're not going to go scream at you.
Yeah, they're pretty mellow until they shoot.
You know, Lazlow and I worked at a radio station where it was above an abortion clinic, and there was bullet holes in the radio station window.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And bomb threats, dude. Yeah. We would have to, you'd be on the air, and there'd be a bomb threat, and you had to put on some long-ass record and be out in the parking lot while the bomb-sniffing dogs went through.
But they're not that crazy.
Yeah, they're not that crazy. They just, you know, got the Lord.
Well, whatever. Look, you got to take a chance. What am I going to do? I'm up on stage every night ripping people apart. I called a woman a C-word this weekend at a club in Pittsburgh, and she freaked out. She went to the owner after it was her 21st birthday. She was there with a whole family. And she said, you called me a C-word on my 21st birthday. She was crying after the show because she wouldn't shut up. She wanted to be the center of attention. She was sitting right in the front. And she's like, I'm not the C-word. I go, you were about 20 minutes ago. Maybe you're not now. You know what I mean? Because she was fine in the lobby. She just wouldn't shut up during a show.
Why do people, I think something's changed. Because I remember comedy a few years ago, people seemed to be a little bit more respectful. But now it's like everybody's yelling junk out during the show. It's like, or if they sort of know part of the bit because they're a fan, they start like helping you finish the bit. It's like, dude, shut up.
The worst is people pick up their cell phone in the middle of a comedy act. You're in the front row and just start talking. Yeah, I'm at the comedy show. Yeah, okay. What are you doing? You know, just... Don't even care.
You grab it and just hang it up and give it back.
I just start screaming.
Really?
Just start screaming at them.
But the people in the front row that, you know, they get picked on, you got to realize you're going to a comedy show. If you're sitting in the front row, you're going to get it. You know, if you're embarrassed or that 21-year-old girl, you should have sat in the back.
Well, you know, it was her and 9 of her girlfriends. Her mom was there, too. So I did it. I sat it in front of her mom, too.
Were they hot?
And she wanted, none of them were hot. And then she wanted me fired from the club the rest of the weekend. She's telling me, I want him fired. He's like, what, are you kidding me? I'm not going to fire him.
If she was knock dead gorgeous, would you?
I still would have said it.
Really?
Absolutely, yeah. Okay. You got it. You know, you,
that's because you're not single, so.
You're in a, no, I don't care. You're in a battle zone up there because they wouldn't stop chatting the whole time. You know what I mean? It's distracting. So I said, because you'll be the people at a movie tomorrow night when you're sober, and someone will be talking behind you, and you'll freak out. I can't believe people are talking while I'm trying to pay attention. I go, that's what you're doing right now. You don't understand it.
That's one of the reasons I can't stand going to the movies. I want to kill everybody in the whole place.
I have to have the 9-seat radius. Nobody can sit near me. No, 3 in front, 2 on the sides. I like to put my feet up, and I'll start yelling in the lobby when I'm buying my ticket. If I hear kids, no talking during the movie, no talking during the movie.
Dude, I was on a, I flew Song for the first time, which, you know, is the ghetto version of Delta. And, you know, it's got the TVs like JetBlue or whatever. But when you fly JetBlue or some of these other airlines with the lowest fares, it's like somebody drove a bus through the projects and just threw everybody on. And it's like there's this woman 2 rows behind me that's got a those little DVD players watching Bugs Bunny with the volume
blaring.
Like, all blaring. I go back and I go, can you get some headphones? And she's like, is it too loud? And I'm like, we're on a plane. There's other people. Then her little brat kid is making all kinds of noise. And, of course, she starts changing his diaper right there on the seat. Dude, I was livid.
Any corn? Yeah, I make it a little more interesting.
I couldn't believe it. They should make flights that are, you know, adults only, no children.
Absolutely. Give a couple of flights a day where it's just adults only. I'll pay $50, $100 extra.
Exactly.
Don't matter.
You ever have a kid who cries the whole time? Just, I mean, at first you're like, all right, his kid, you kind of want to have some sympathy, but then when it just doesn't stop, like the third hour in, it's happened before.
There's medication for that.
Yeah. Or the kids called Jack Daniels.
The kids that take the mom's cell phone and play with it, and then they go through every single ring.
Oh. I know. Yeah. The cell phone's become a toy now.
Mm-hmm. But now they said there's something on the internet that you can make phone calls for, so you're going to be able to make phone calls through your laptop. I was just reading about that.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, people are just going to be screaming at their laptop, put it on, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I was just reading about that they, you know, the FCC can't regulate that because it's on the laptop, but people do it on their planes. They got the laptop on. They could do it, call right through.
Yeah,
there.
They'll just do voiceover IP.
That's going to be horrible.
That's when you just break out the porn and start watching it at full volume.
Oh, sure. They're still seriously considering allowing mobile phones on planes. It's very easy to do. You just put a dish like they do for satellite. And, you know, then you've got the biatch next to you going on and on.
Oh, that's
going to
be awful. I get bumped up to first class. I never fly first class. I'm a creep. You know what I mean? But because I fly so much, I get bumped up every once in a while. And I was in first class like 2 weeks ago, and this guy is screaming in his cell phone. This was before the plane took off, screaming right in front of me. And I just went, shh, like that. And he turns around and he looks. And I'm just staring at him. I do it. He starts screaming again. He goes, and he turns around. He goes, I paid $1,400 for this ticket. I go, so did I. And he just said, I got some idiot behind me. I got to go. And he hung up. And there was so much tension in the first class.
I know.
Beautiful. And then as soon as the plane landed, he got back on and just started screaming. I was just staring at him the whole time. Everyone's like, oh, this is going to be a fight.
Dude, the whole cell phone thing's BS. You know, they say if you use it on the plane, it's going to mess with the flight controls.
No, absolutely not.
They're just doing that because they want you to use their phones, right?
Sure. It messes with the revenue structure.
Right.
What it does. There was a woman that was like robbing banks while talking on her cell phone.
Oh, yeah, I saw that. And she was getting away with it,
too. In Northern Virginia, she was just like, and they, nobody has ever seen any other robber talking on the phone. And she talks on the phone during the entire robbery.
But that way,
she probably didn't even plan that. Chicks just like to babble. So, you know what I mean? She's like, I got to rob a bank. But uh-huh. So where are we going to go later? I want to go to the mall.
This line is taking forever.
You're going to pick me up in 5 minutes.
It's Black Friday. I'm almost there.
It also leaves you a way out, too, because you're going to be all, give me all the money. No, I was talking to my friend. You know, if she starts freaking out, you're out of the bank. No, I was talking to my friend on the phone.
That's why, you know, I was playing with that cell phone jammer. A lot of fun, but, you know, I had to get rid of it because it's a federal offense to own it.
That was fun. That time we were in Vancouver, we were stuck for 8 hours drinking. Remember that? You're like, let's just search for somebody on the phone. And we could tell the guy in front of us in the car was on his cell phone. We tap into it. We put in all the speakers in the car.
Yeah, that was pretty entertaining.
Oh, that's great.
I got to say, I gave Wayne a scanner, and he was listening to cordless phone conversations around his neighborhood.
I got
to
say, it was great. It's like this 17-year-old chick constantly getting calls from young guys, and she's like, I'm in the bathtub. What are you doing? I'm like, don't hurry up. I need to finish up here. But it was great.
And
I
then you recognize her voice. Oh, that's the girl next door.
Yeah, pretty much.
So did you do anything while you...
Yeah, me and my wife would actually lay there and, you know, it would turn us on.
Really?
Yeah, sure.
Your wife was into it too?
Oh, without a doubt.
Oh, that's beautiful. She's a good sport.
Without a doubt. It was excellent.
Really?
Yes. The best was it was in a 3-mile radius. I knew like this scan I couldn't get out of, like, I live in Long Beach, so I couldn't leave like Long Beach. So it's right. Like as you're driving around, you're looking at like every city. It could have been, huh? It yeah. could have been. Huh?
Why don't you tell everybody?
You need a visual, right?
Tell everybody what intersection you're at so that they know.
It could be Long Beach, New Jersey.
Long Beach Island.
Yeah.
You know what most people don't realize, when you have a cordless phone, you basically have a small radio station in your hand. When you talk into that cordless phone, people how many houses away can pick up that conversation just by buying a cheap scanner at Radio Shack.
I switch my code like every 2 months, you know, when you're calling your buddy for, you know, your weed. You're like, okay, this week it's green shirts. He's like, do you want the designer? No, just give me the Walmart brand this time. All right, that's fine with me. Medium? No, large.
But see, that's what people think, they're so smart when they're...
Right, the cops are all
of it. The cops like, oh, green shirts. He must like green shirts. Like, oh, he's not, you know...
You want to have a snowball fight? Sure, come on over. Big one, small one.
That's funny, man.
The valedictorian at my high school, used to call him, call Hits of Acid, he called comic books. Dude, read a great comic book last night. The color and the inking, right on.
You want to read it? I've got an extra copy.
Exactly.
$7.
$7. What do people in Queens, what do they call?
Acid.
No,
they don't care.
It's called mescaline. It was Mickey Mouse acid. Had a little Mickey Mouse on it or something like that.
How about the Woodstock? Did you ever see that with the little Peanuts guy?
Yes, that too. Yeah, Superman.
Superman.
Yeah,
never tried. The big Superman.
S. 4-way pyramid gel. Oh, I ran into Dad on that.
That was always the worst. Don't
that
talk
was not
to
pretty.
Don't talk to Mom on acid. Bad idea.
My buddies are behind his back drinking. They turn around and sees me laughing. They'd hide their beers, which is even make it even funnier. Then we got on a Ferris wheel. That's all I remember.
And it is, you can see why they used it as truth serum, you know, during the wars or whatever, because it's like you come into the house and, you know, Mom's like, well, for instance, in my case, Mom's like, so how'd your night go? And I go, totaled the car. So,
and she thinks you're joking. But you're not.
And you're not.
I remember once I was on PCP from my mom. And I come home from school with my buddies with me, and my mom walks in the room, and then she walks back out. I look at my buddy, I'm like, dude, who was that? He's like, that's your mom. I'm like, get me out of here now. So then he's sneaking me out of the house. My mom's like, where are you going? And my buddy's like, he's acting like he's me. He's like, we'll be right out. We'll be back in an hour or so. He had to play like he was me and just rush me out of the house.
Oh, and I'm sure that went over well.
It worked.
Throw a Visine before you get home in your eyes, right?
That all red. Never works.
No, that always worked for me, though.
Oh, yeah, because I told my mom one point, like, yeah, I do this. She's like, I know, and the Banaca and the Visine don't work. We've all been there.
Well, I did have the Banaca.
Doesn't work.
Ready to make out?
With your mom?
No.
Maybe. Yeah, why'd you need a Banaca?
He is from Oklahoma.
She's family.
I am from Oklahoma. See, but Wayne just gave up. He just told his mom, I'm smoking in front of you. And he would sit there at Thanksgiving dinner rolling big Dutch Masters.
Yeah, like 14, I'd come home from school, well, you know, hanging out. I was like, I got integrated. And it's like, I didn't give a crap, man.
You got what?
Integrated. It was a lucrative integration.
I don't know.
That's what it was.
I think that's when you're in an accurate Integra.
I was given the third degree. Who are you with? Where's with your money and all this stuff? I'm broke, asking for more money.
The kineticism of it all.
Wayne has his own language, if you'll notice.
Yeah, I've been picking that up.
But you knew what I meant, right?
Yeah, I knew what you meant.
Okay, you just didn't know how to spell it.
Yeah. Either you. He can pronounce it, at least.
Your mom didn't care? Did you smoke pot right in front of her?
No.
She used to have little cute names for it.
Yeah, like she would, Jim, are you use Dutch Masters? You familiar with that type of rolling? So I occasionally would unroll one and forget where I put it. She'd be like, oh, you left your lettuce over here.
Lettuce?
Yeah, my lettuce.
Oh, lettuce.
She referred to the outside layer as a piece of lettuce.
I was never really into the drugs. I smoked pot for a little bit, but other than that, I'd always be at parties with like strippers or something like that, and they'd be doing coke or smoking pot. I'd always just light up a cigarette if they were smoking pot and just fake like I was smoking, you know what I mean? When it came around, smoked a cigarette, blow that smoke out.
Hmm.
You know, because it just didn't do anything for me. Because I would get paranoid and tired. You know what I mean? You want to party with strippers, you don't want to get tired. And you don't want to be paranoid. If you're around a stripper and you think you get paranoid, you're not having sex with her.
Right.
You know
what I mean? Like, at mid-bang, you're like, rubber breaks, I've got AIDS. Rubber breaks, I've got AIDS.
Rubbers, please. I wasn't wearing them.
Yeah. Same here, Jim. Rubbers.
This is the Lazlow Show. Coming up on a little bit, we got to get to Reed Tucker's Stalker. Plus, we've got some other audio and bits to get to, but we should go into... Somebody mentioned the Peanuts.
Oh, the girl that died?
Peanuts? No, not the girl. The show.
The music.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Well, it's real good seeing y'all here. Due to the shortage of time, we'll get right down to work.
It's like a remix.
I just don't understand it. What is it you want? What is it you want?
What is it you want?
I don't know.
What is it you want?
That's the problem.
Good grief. All right now. All right. That's it, Charlie Brown. That's it, Charlie Brown. That's it, Charlie Brown.
What kind of Christmas music is that?
Listen, all of you.
This is the music.
Hey, you don't get it at all. You know.
Okay.
Hey, you know, Santa Claus. Hey, Santa Claus and ho ho ho.
Guess what?
What?
Disaster time.
All right.
It's all wrong.
It's all well.
I don't see what all the fuss is about.
It's not bad. Really? You do that so well.
What's going on here?
That's it, Charlie Brown.
All right. Let's take it from the top again. Here we go.
Yeah, do something right for a change, Charlie Brown. Brown.
Well, I guess we better concentrate.
Yeah.
There's a play on words here, you see? Think about that. It was
that.
Beautiful.
That. Lunch break.
Break. Lunch break.
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 It's fun.
Break.
Break.
Don't worry.
It's fun. Don't you think it's great?
Everything I touch gets ruined. Everything I do turns into a disaster.
You drive me crazy.
All right. There's no time for foolishness.
What do you want?
The proper move. You got it. We're back.
I never get what I really want.
What is it you want?
Just 10 money.
How about 10 and 20?
10 and 20?
All I want is what I have coming to me. All I want is my fair share.
Christmas is all about Charlie Brown.
The Lazlow Show.
Y'all are listening to The Lazlow Show on K-Rock in New York City.
We should send Reed out to get more IDs. I was a redneck he interviewed in.
I want one that says 92.3 K-Rock, Big Wayne, period.
Whoa.
Oh, that was my...
That'd be a good
what
one.
Are you doing over there, Jim Florentine?
Just adjusting the volume.
Wow.
I used to DJ. You think I would notice stuff, but...
Did you really?
Yeah, I used to DJ like... clubs and bars and stuff like that. I did weddings for a little while.
Oh,
awful.
Dude, I've known some buddies of mine to make a lot of extra money have DJed at weddings. They said it is like the pit of hell.
When you first start out in this business, that's what they think too. Like, oh, you're a DJ? Really? Do you do weddings? And they, you know, a lot of the part timers, that's what they do. Or people would ask me, "Hey, would you like to do our wedding?" As opposed to just go and enjoy it with everybody else? No.
Yeah. When you're like 20 years old, it's like, you know, I was getting like $300 for like 4 hours. So that was good money, but I had to wear a tuxedo. It was awful.
It'd be like somebody, you know, like one of your friends now. Hey, Jim, you coming to the wedding? Yeah. You want to do a couple minutes of stand-up while you're at the...
Well, I get that all the time.
No.
Absolutely. No. Yeah.
Is Bob the plumber going to be working on the toilet, you know, during the reception? No.
If something breaks.
You're going to call on him?
You got to step up.
When my brother Dan got married, he was like, "I want you to be my best man." I'm like, "You sure?" And he's like, "Yeah." I go, "Okay." I did 15 minutes on him and his wife. And the last minute, I said nice stuff about him. At 14, I just ripped him apart. I was like, "What else
am
I going to do?" Yeah.
I was my brother.
It was a roast. It was at his wedding. He spent $40,000 at his wedding, and I'm ripping him apart.
I was my brother's best man, and his wife is from Colombia, South America. Or actually, no, Chile. So you realize half the people at the place don't understand English. So I'm sitting there giving the toast, and then you realize every other word, like, blah, 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 you know, he's loved her with all his heart. And you're just like, you know, you're throwing out, like, the Spanish words, amor. Oh, and then you see a perk up. Oh, he said something we understand.
Right. Chimichanga. Yeah.
I remember I ruined this one couple's wedding. I was playing 45s at the time, whatever, right? And I think they're...
45s? What are you, 800 years old?
Yeah, but, you know, they
I used to put two controllers next to each other.
And he's never mooned anybody.
You know what I mean? You get the singles, whatever. They were like 99 cents. I'm not going to buy a whole Cool in the Gang album.
This next one is Pennsylvania 65,000. I'm Jim Florentine.
Well, look, I didn't have it on 8-track. You know, they were out of it. What was I going to do?
It's time for the chicken dance.
But I left it. It was their wedding song, so I put it on. I introduced them. Here's whatever. And I put the 45 on, but I had it on 33 speed on the turntable. Because I had a record on before that, I didn't realize it, and I had to take a number two really bad because I was nervous that I just talked in front of 200 people. So I was really shy, so I just put it on, I made the announcement, and I ran to the bathroom, and I'm in the bathroom, and I can't even hear what's going on, and it's on the wrong speed, their wedding song. And I'm in a bathroom. I'm just like, all right, I got like 3.5 minutes, you know, and I'm in a stall, and I hear a guy go, "Where the hell did that DJ go? I can't believe he messed up the song." And I'm like, I'm sitting there on the ball, like, how could I have messed up the song?
Actually, if it was on 33, you had 7 minutes.
You're right. I came in with like 30 seconds left in the song, and everyone's just staring at me. I'm like, why is everybody looking at me? I hear, Richard. I'm like, oh my God.
This is the Lazlow Show. Jim Florentine hanging out in studio. Cousin Ed has come up from WYSP. We should just say that you're just a regular part of the show. We shouldn't even say that you're visiting.
Well, yeah, I don't have a caricature yet, so I guess I'm not a regular part of the show.
Big Wayne... also here, and then Reed Tucker, who is in the corner evidently and doesn't want to be part of this. What are you reading over there, Esquire?
The Post.
Good. Get your dose of nonsense.
He's really read about that bar mitzvah that girl had. Did you read about that?
Oh, it was the...
She had 50 Cent and, like, Aerosmith at a bar mitzvah.
Yeah, $2 million. Joe Perry and Steve Pyla got.
And Tom Petty was the MC.
Tom Petty got $10.
Do you know what the guy does for a living?
He sells body armor to soldiers and police.
Vest. He's making a fortune off this war.
He's getting investigating
him for something? Yeah.
Yeah, probably because he's putting aluminum cans in those things. Those guys are getting blown apart over there.
And he's getting high with 50 Cent in the back room while his daughter's wearing a yarmulke or whatever they do. I don't know what the girls wear.
Dude, speaking of how, you know, like the military... I saw this article in the New York Times yesterday that there's people that want to sign up, that want to go serve the country and help out in Afghanistan or Iraq, and now they're starting to crack down on tattoos. Like, you can't go in based on where you have tattoos located.
Why?
I think it's crazy. You want...
Like, that's when tattoos started. You were in the military. Like, way back when. Those the only people that had tattoos were those. My father's like, "See my Navy dad, don't ever get a tattoo, boy."
Yeah, those
that's what all the kids should do if they're afraid a draft might be coming up, is just go get a million tattoos and they'll get accepted.
Brilliant.
I think it's the facial ones, the ones that they're going after.
No, dude, they're going after the black ink, if it spills out past the collar, or... there's a new policy that bars recruits who have tattoos that are visible or that cover more than 25% of a limb. So even if, you know, you can cover it up. There was a guy that was a former Marine.
I'd have a problem if I got my initials on my penis then. That would cover more than 25%.
Oh, boy.
I used to think that till last week.
Why, what happened? You were listening to that 17-year-old in the bath, and it grew?
Something like that, yeah.
His wife was happy.
And now the Kentucky State Police has rejected applicants who have tattoos that will be visible while they're in uniform. San Diego and Houston police departments require officers to cover arm tattoos with their shirt sleeves regardless of the weather.
Well, that's different. Police officers? Yeah. But I, if there's a draft, you know they're going to get rid of that rule.
Of course. They'll never have a draft again, dude. They're so done with that because that is the sure way to get everybody against you politically. You'd be out of your mind.
Don't you still have to register, though?
Do people still have to register for the selective service? Do you remember doing that?
At my age, I think that year that it was reinforced, I had to sign up.
They would give you a drug test, and the person administering the drug test would fall apart from the fumes.
And what's any different than half the other military guys that
were
there?
Yeah, they would smell way and go, forget it.
We got an email from Africa. we were talking about this earlier in the show.
Can you say the address? The guy's, I want to know what his email address is. It's like Mandupu
dot.
Dot.
At.
Dot.
At AZT.com. Sorry.
Wow.
I don't think he's listening.
Well, he
if it's from India, it'd be dot@dot.com.
Okay. Thanks for you know you're bombing when you have to explain it. Why don't you take some comedy advice from Jim Florentine?
Don't do that.
I'll have protesters if I do.
What do you do if you're bombing up on stage?
Keep plowing away.
Just call somebody the C-word?
No, I don't do that. No, I just whatever. You just keep what are you gonna do? I bombed many times before. I think I'm actually gonna bomb this Thursday on The Apprentice. I did an episode of The Apprentice.
Really?
Yeah. I have a feeling it was at I don't know how much I could talk about it, but whatever. I don't know. It was like a charity event. They had a comedian there, and I was up there in like a Wednesday 13, this like, rock band t-shirt when everyone was in black ties, and I was telling dirty jokes, and people were disgusted. So I don't know how much they're going to show, but I taped it like 4 months ago.
Wow.
But it's going to air this Thursday. We'll see what they show. I was making fun of the guy at Trump's right-hand man, the old guy. I was asking if he wears a diaper and stuff. He was sitting in the front with his wife. They were disgusted. It was beautiful. The guy was sweating that ran it, because he's like one of the finalists or whatever. It was beautiful.
If you never bombed, you're not trying. You're not trying new material. You're not being risky enough.
Exactly. You're just going in and doing the same thing over and over.
I'm trying too much. I just bomb all the time.
Yeah, I know.
Well, I've seen Ed host those events, those rock events or whatever. You just say, are you guys drinking? You always get him with that one.
Right? Just curse. We did one for the hymn shows on Thanksgiving Eve or something. I go up there, our spokesmodel, Tanya. I was like, all right, I'll get the whole crowd going. I give it to her, introduce the band. She's like, oh, I forgot to say happy Thanksgiving, everybody. And I'm like, nobody can hear. I'm like, happy Thanksgiving. The whole crowd's like, happy Thanksgiving. It was great.
Right, and then you just go, in Philly, you're like, hey, you guys ready for the Eagles Sunday, yeah. Right? And then the place goes nuts. You win them back every time.
Like it's spelling bee time. E-A. All right, for the 18th million time, we can spell Eagles.
I was listening to audio from one of those K-Rock concerts they had, and people have to go up and introduce bands. I mean, I would hate to have to do that to like a whole ton of people out there. And so, you pull the obligatory, who's drinking it? Yo, smoking some weed? You know that one's going to get like, hey.
I refuse to go up alone anymore. Because Tanya's there, a spokesmodel. You bring a girl, it doesn't matter what you say. Because they're looking at her. And it's before Thanksgiving. It's like, all right, here's Tanya. Who wants to see some breast meat? So then we get an email complaint. This guy goes, I saw Ed up on stage at the hymn show, and he said something about breast meat, and at that point, I expected Tanya to take her shirt off, and she didn't.
Oh, he was protesting that she didn't.
He's like, who do I talk to? Because he said breast meat, and I didn't see any.
What? Did you pay money?
Did I?
No, the person.
Like, to get in a concert, but not to see her. He had to buy her a damn purse.
Go to a strip club.
Yeah, that's true.
A strip club. It'll be Jim Florentine in between acts.
But I just thought he thought he...
Did we? I did strip club. I know
you told us about that last
time. That's right, yeah.
Well, that's got to be a bad... Who wants to see you?
It was brutal. Because it was one of those bring-your-owns. So you bring a cooler in. You know what I mean? It's all nude. It's like a bad fishing trip. Bunch of drunk guys. The girls are nude. They're hot. And then all of a sudden, in between, all right, here's a comedian. Boo! Who the hell are you throwing? They would throw beer cans at us. Me, Jim Norton, Bob Levy, a bunch of us used to do it. But we paid like $500 for like a Friday and Saturday night. So I was like, all right, whatever. And they would give us free lap dances. So in between the sets, we'd have to hide from all the guys because they hated us so bad we couldn't walk through the crowd. Because they'd be like, you better not go back up there again. I want to see some, you know... I don't want to see you.
Right.
I'm going to be screaming at you. And they, oh, here's a comedian. Are you guys ready for your comedian again? No! Boo!
I go visit my boy Jackie Bam Bam, the godfather of Go-Go down in Philly at, you know, his place. He's like, can we get up on stage with me? No.
That was the weirdest. When I walked into that place with cheerleaders.
The leader.
Yeah, I was there that night.
Yeah, you were there that night. It was the night of Cousin Ed's Babe Fest. And we walk in, and Jackie Bam Bam's up on the mic. It's the first time I've ever walked into a strip club. And somebody over like the loudspeaker's like, and Lazlow's in the house! So I was like, well, this is a little odd.
He's got sparklers at the end of his microphone. He's running around with a G-string. It's not pretty.
He's crazy. But, dude, Cousin Ed in that place, it's like he owns the place. He jumps over the bar. He's swinging with the chicks on the poles.
I put in my time.
Yeah,
he has
put in his time. And evidently, Florentine has, too, because like everywhere we went in Philly... It's like every bar, hey, Florentine's back. Hey, Cousin Ed's back. And then the place would close, and they would hand us cases of beer to go over to some, and every
It was after, we had an after party at 3 o'clock, like, yeah, we're going to take two cases of beer, and thanks.
And every one of your friends in Philly has a pool table in their living room.
And porn chicks in their bedrooms.
Are you going to, now, are you able to use your pool table right now? Because a dog went to the bathroom on it.
Well, I had a cover. He went on the American flag, too.
Was it America? There's an American flag covering your pool table.
Yeah, and I called my father first time ever.
Maybe it's a crime scene. They're filming the accused, too.
I put my father on my radio show first time ever.
Close enough.
And it was like, because he's Mr. Military. He's like, if you have an American flag outside your house, and
have a light.
Yeah, so he has a light on it permanently. If not, at dusk, you have to take it down. If it touches the ground, you burn it. So I call him. I was like, yeah, the girlfriend's dog jumped on the pool table and, went on it. What do I do now? I mean, is it a terrorist? He's like,
terrorist.
You have to get rid of it. You have to burn it. Thanks, Dad. Is that it? Yes.
You must burn it.
And this is why you're never on the show, Dad. Okay. He gets all mad because my mom's on it. He's not.
Have you, my father's like, how come you never have me on the show? So much to talk about. And
you don't want him to hear what you're saying.
Oh, exactly. Dude, the day that he goes and starts downloading this show from the website, I'm done. He will never talk to me again.
I found out today my girlfriend's grandmother now tunes in. Yep, she's a big fan now. Oh, boy. That's a different audience. Don't tune into my show on Tuesday because it's going to be really bad.
So this guy in Africa said it's 20 CAT, which is Central Africa Time, or in the African language, I believe. it says you not only have Matt the Marine listening, but Billy the ex-SADF infantry who also hunted insurgents, but we did not go crikey.
Crikey.
Crikey. That's Matt the Marine. Matt the Marine hasn't been on the show.
He's disappeared after Labor Day.
I know. It's, I don't know where he went.
Maybe he went back.
We're looking for insurgents.
Yeah, there he is. he's Australian, and then he came to America, and it's like, you know what? Land of promise, land of plenty. I think I'll join the Marines. Like a week later, welcome to Baghdad, son. So this says we don't go crikey. We're coin ops, which is counterinsurgency operations. They fought SWAPO. Anybody know what that is? SWAPO? Southwest
Swahili,
Asian people, and the Cubans in Angola. Did we fight the Cubans? Did I miss a war? Is it 84, 85? Reed?
I don't think so.
No idea. In Angola?
I don't know.
I had a fight with a Puerto Rican guy who tried to break in my car. Does that count?
It was an all-out war.
That's Puerto Rican and Cuba. Ain't that two different places?
Nah, it's all the same.
Probably not.
He said he was in Company 21C, which was a black battalion. The officers were white, and the NCOs were white. And they said back then they didn't have drug testing, so you could smoke weed and be in the Marines. But these days,
if you're going to go to another country, you got to be able to enjoy.
Well, you can. They random drug test, and if you get caught, everybody in your platoon goes home.
That's a good way to get out of it.
I like that. Let's go home, fellas.
Guess what?
I got some comic book. You ready to go home?
I think we're all done here, ladies and gentlemen. That's right. We caught Bin Laden? No. All right. Out we go.
But most of those Middle Eastern countries are dry anyway. I know Kuwait is. I'm pretty sure Iraq is. Afghanistan with liquor.
Well, yeah. But you know what I mean? You can buy just big balls of hash on the side of the road for like a dollar. So I've heard.
That they mix with plastic.
I was in Kuwait, and they didn't have any beer at all, man. It was awful, and you couldn't bring any pot in the country.
What were you doing in Kuwait?
I performed for the troops a few years back. Yeah.
What war was that? Korean?
No, it was before, actually, 9-11. It was about a few months before. It was cool. They took me up in the chopters through the desert and stuff like that, showed me all the burned-out vehicles from the first war.
They let you like, handle a machine gun and shoot some brown people?
Yeah, it was cool. Yeah.
You got to shoot some rounds?
Yeah.
No, I said browns.
Browns.
Brown people.
Took you up in a Black Hawk down, and those guys love to show off. You know, it was me and the other comedian. They're freaking doing all these circles. Oh, yeah, it was awful. And the doors are open. They don't even have doors. He's just holding on.
Let's kill a family of 12 for Florentine. Come on.
That's excellent.
Jim, you're looking green.
But you know, can they drink during the shows?
No.
Another sober show.
Yeah, there's no alcohol over there. And you're not allowed to look at the women over there in Kuwait. Like they tell you when you get in the country, don't look
at spank them on the ass.
Don't look at their women. You know what I mean? It's really offensive.
What happens?
I don't know. Did
car bomb?
Probably. I don't know. It's very disrespectful. But they don't show anything anyway. You just see their eyes.
Exactly. They look
Who
like
looks
like
in a girl's eyes? The only time I do, I'm like, oh, she's sleeping. Let me get in real quick. You know what I mean? Other than that, why would I look at her eyes?
She won't notice.
Is that wrong, Wayne?
No.
Because if Wayne said that's wrong, then all right, maybe I should.
I like it. I got to tell you, I'm going to use it in the future.
I just like that he's looking for Wayne for judgment. Is that okay? Yeah,
because, I know. Right, this is the... This is
wait, I was asking Wayne something. Wayne, have you ever had sex with a girl that was passed out?
Yeah, sure. Sure, come on, who hasn't?
Now, did she know when she woke up?
I think I had to tell her, but she didn't know.
Romantic moments with Big Wayne.
So how often, you know, these days, that's the R word.
Yes, it is, yeah. Back when I was young, though, no meant yes. It was like, come on, take your shirt off. No, no, no. Come on, take your shirt off. No, no. Oh, okay. So then you went for the next, though. Let's open the pants. No, no, no.
The best trick ever, whenever, like, you got to hook up with a girl, so you could stay over, but I just want to let you know right now, nothing is going to happen.
Oh, yeah.
But you know what you do is you just go, no, I don't want anything to happen. That's fine. You know what I mean? I just want to crash. I'm beat. You know what I mean? It's a long drive.
They just want to cuddle. They just want to hold.
No, no, but when you throw that back at them, that's when they want to have sex with you. They're like, wait a minute. Now this guy doesn't want me. What's going on here? And then you get in the bed with them. You don't make a move on them. Next thing you know, they're grabbing you. It works.
Exactly.
9 out of 10 times would work all the time. Just one comedian on a scale of 1 to 10 was like a 1.5. Sure, the guy would never get laid. And I told him, I go, next time you do that, just tell him, I don't want anything to happen either. The guy called me like a week later, goes, you don't understand. He goes, this girl was like a 9.5, and I used your line on her, and she was all over me, and I had sex with her. I cannot believe that thing worked. The guy idolizes me to this day.
I idolize you for using that line at when we were hanging out with those porn stars and strippers after Cousin Ed's Babe Fest in Philly, and you're like, you look a lot like my girlfriend.
Is that where?
Then they figure you're harmless. You're like, all right, you know, and he's got a girlfriend, so it's like, I'm not just some creepy guy just hitting on him, you know?
Yeah, especially with that voice, they would never think you're just a creepy
guy. Exactly.
I still have dreams about that blonde girl to this day. Angelina?
Oh, yeah.
My God. She was
Are the pictures of that
gorgeous.
Night still up on the side, or are they down?
She came. She lives in Orlando or something like that, or Tampa. She came to one of my shows when I was in Orlando. Couple months ago, yeah.
She is.
Oh, so you stayed in touch with her?
No, she knew I was down there or something like that, and she came out to our show. We did some rock club down there.
You got any stalkers?
No.
None? You haven't had any, like, weirdos that follow, you know, go show to show, like a dead show, or?
Not really, no. They don't do that with comedy, you know, it's like...
Not even same city, like every time you go back to Philly, there's one guy.
Yeah, you know, they'll come, but that's cool. I don't mind that, you know. Kim.
Yeah, because Reed's got a guy that is evidently sort of tracking him down, like sending him packages in the mail. What did he send you?
He sent me his copy of Grand Theft Auto 3 to sign with a note, was nice. I mean, it's my first fan letter. So
return postage?
Yeah. Put 2 stamps in there and everything.
Well, where's the note? Did you bring it?
Yeah, I got it.
Where is it?
You gonna read it?
Yeah.
Wayne smoked it. I don't know, you know, because I've always like been a big. Like heavy metal guys, so I've always stalked rock stars, so I don't even know if people are stalking me because I'm a stalker myself.
Look at the note.
This is it. It's on a 3x5 note card.
My God, he was like, I'm making flashcards in science class.
I know.
Why do all fan letters, all those fans have the worst writing, too? It's like they write like a 3-year-old.
I don't know if anybody's ever looked at this. This is like from like a kindergarten
kid.
This is like, this is done as a school project. Let's see if we can get it to a celebrity.
I didn't even know they made index cards anymore.
The hell for Stay Between the Lines.
Yeah, I thought all kids had laptops and iPods now.
So, yeah, so this is what I got right here.
Oh, so read it.
See, I like this. He sticks out for me. It says, Dear Reed, you are the greatest person in the galaxy. Let's stretch it out a little bit. Yeah, not just the planet, the galaxy.
Include the four Japs in the International Space Station.
It says, and then now it gets to a little tag on Lazlow. Ignore Lazlow's taunts. And then in all capital letters, with a little bit of a shaky hand, you are awesome. Exclamation. You were hilarious in Chatterbox and even better on the Lazlow Show. Can you please sign my copy of Grand Theft Auto 3? That would seriously make my life so much better. P.S. I only had one envelope big enough. Sorry. Frowny face.
Frowny face.
Yeah. Truly yours, Andrew.
Truly yours.
And you know the guy obsessed for like 2 hours over how do I sign this, you know?
Well, especially so
like,
when his hand is getting shaky during
love.
Now, how is his life
sincerely,
really going to improve by having a signed copy of Grand Theft?
Yeah, I don't know. This is the mystery. I don't know. And why, out of all the people, I mean, why not send it to Lazlow? I mean, at least Lazlow is like a name brand.
Everybody's got their, you know, different person that they like. You
I
know?
Guess. All I do is open the door and get drinks around here. And then apparently that's straight to his heart.
It's right. Handwriting like this, these are the ones that scare you, though. Like, you better sign this and send it back.
Yeah, I did.
Okay.
Yeah, because Cousin Ed and I have both been seriously stalked.
Yes.
So.
I've been tracked down at the DMV and all kinds of crap. It's not pretty.
DMV?
Yeah.
What'd they do?
Yeah, the girl like went and followed me and got my license and went to the DMV and paid her friend to look at my address and my name and my number. And.
But at least it's a girl.
Still.
She was a big one.
Did you bang her?
She was a big one.
Did you bang her?
No.
Yeah, I learned my lesson. I banged a stalker.
Oh.
That was just a bad idea.
I remember the first girl I met over the radio was down in Norfolk, and she sounded so hot. She'd call every night, and like, yeah, you get into it in between songs, whatever. I was like, hey, I work this bar. Why don't you come out? Shows up at the bar, and literally she walks up, and this girl not only shopped at the Husky section, but here's the bar, and she's like this tall. She was a little one. She was like 3'5".
Oh, a little one.
Yeah, munchy. She's like, she goes, is Ed here? And I went,
No.
I think he's in the back. I'll go get him. And I ran to the back to my boss. I said, cover for me. I'm going on break. And I didn't come back out for another hour. And after that, I was like, never go out with a girl you meet on the radio. Never. They're never as hot as you think they are.
You go out with chicks at comedy shows, Florentine?
No, you know,
but
we
then
don't
you
get groupies,
them.
Though.
Right,
you
at
know?
Least then you could see them.
It's more couples that come to the shows.
Oh,
you know?
So you're a swinger. Good.
No, not really. One couple wanted me to bang. The guy wanted me to bang his wife.
Really?
Yeah. He's like, look, you know, they want to. You know, my wife wants to do it, and I want her to do it because if I do it with her, she's gonna have me go with a girlfriend. He goes, so you know, you want to do it? I said, okay.
So was he in the room?
Yeah, he was in the room.
Oh, that's creepy.
You know what I've always thought?
Yeah,
about?
And the guy was high-fiving me too.
While you were doing it?
Yeah.
Did he keep his clothes on?
No, he had them out too.
He had the little guy out.
We'll work at both ends.
Oh, rotisserie style. So
I've always thought about, if you were banging a girl, to just break out like the Special Ed voice, like right in the middle of it.
Yay.
I've done that before. Whatever I need to do, you know.
I've always had a fantasy of being banged by a puppet.
Right.
This is pre-puppet days, so.
You want some more?
I got some big boy milk for you. Can I say that?
You just did. Right.
That can mean anything.
Right.
Yeah.
Milk does a body good, from what I understand.
Let me run to the refrigerator.
Yes. Thank you, American Dairy Council.
Does a body good.
So we got invited to the K-Rock Christmas party.
Did you?
Yeah, we did. I don't think we're going to go.
Am I invited or just you three?
But you work at the sister station in Philly.
So I can come.
Well, yeah, if you want to. But, dude, Christmas parties at radio stations are so boring because everybody else is, there's the one person who's on the air, the person who's about to come on the air, and everybody else is not going to come in just for the party.
I wonder here if everybody's invited, because I've been to, you know, stations sometimes, and, like, the part-timers don't get to go, the board ops don't get invited, and it's just this weird selection process. I don't like going because the boss is always there, though.
And you can't party I mean, you really can't enjoy yourself because you're going to get liquored up and you're going to shoot your mouth off.
One of our bosses just recently got divorced, and ever since then he's like, dude, I know you're always out, you're the king of the bars and restaurants in Old City. He goes, I want to go out with you. And he's like, a year later, he goes, how come every time I'm asking you to go out with you for like a year? And we still haven't. I'm like, yeah, because yeah. I'm not getting drunk in front of you.
You take a hint.
Yeah, who knows what I'll say. Or do.
I've never been to a Christmas party because I never had a job like that, like a responsible job.
Well, there's no drugs at the family or the work Christmas party, first of all. So there's where it's not.
Well,
really
no, you sneak out. You sneak outside.
Oh, not me.
No?
Hmm. Well, yeah, you don't be high. Especially when you work for a rock station. Like, no, nobody's going to know. Yeah, the boss has been working at rock radio how many 3 years, you know? And, he won't notice your eyes are bloodshot and you're stoned.
What's like when Doogie went to go work at KBCO? In Colorado. He goes, yeah, I got to take a blood test. I go, are you
in Colorado?
I go, are you kidding me? You have to take a drug test to work at a radio station?
But of all radio stations, Colorado, with all the hippies, are getting high anyway.
No kidding.
Yeah, I'm not working there.
You may not be working at YSP much longer. How are your ratings?
Hey, I got, I have at least till the 31st, right?
Do you? And then what?
I don't know. It's January.
Ed will be there.
Yeah,
you're a legend at that station.
Cousin Cockroach. Can't get rid of me.
Well, yeah, you've done every air shift there.
Yeah, Cousin Beachball. That'll do it.
Florentine comes and hangs out with you. You record your whole show in like an hour, and then you go to the bar.
Yeah, absolutely.
I thought you were working. I am working.
I know. Let's get out of here. Let's go to the bar.
Another shot of Jaeger, thank you.
Wayne, are you...
Imagine if Wayne had to go to a Christmas party. Like
Wayne here?
Wayne's just hanging out. Enjoying the show.
I know. He's like sitting in the back. It's like his lifelong dream to meet Jim Florentine.
I'm mesmerized really
same
right
here,
now.
I know it.
They both they got drool coming out the sides of their mouths. You guys want to sit closer?
Like, Wayne, what would you do if you had a job where you had to get drug tested?
I wouldn't have that job.
It's called unemployment.
Listen, there's two things in life I chose over to have to accept that I have a drug problem.
Right.
That's employment and my wife.
Now, your wife knows about the drug problem.
Very much so.
And she doesn't care.
And your mom, apparently, too.
Well, she's no
and
longer
she doesn't
around.
Care?
No, she doesn't care. No, I mean, it's I'm a controlled recreational drug user.
2 ounces a week?
It's controlled?
That's right. Reasonable.
Except when Chemical Chris
comes. We're not talking Hydro. We're talking regular. Now, Hydro might be 1 ounce a week.
The Walmart t-shirt, not designer.
Right, exactly.
Except when Chemical Chris comes through with his Percocets and his Vicodins. And
I've been good.
Well, I was hanging out with you recently, and then the next day, you're like, you know I was on pills, right? And I was like, I had no idea.
No, I don't remember that.
You got to tell me what you're on when I'm hanging out with you.
Life.
Those are the nights that make me feel good. When I wake up the next morning, I'm like, wow, I was really wasted last night. And your best friends are like, really, you were? I'm like, wow, I pulled it off. I am good.
Man. Yeah, but that's also kind of a scream for help.
No, it's not. Who needs help?
When... You do. Your entire freezer is bottles of booze.
Listen. You got a kegerator in your refrigerator. Yeah. Who's got a problem here?
I got beer taps on the front of my fridge.
Do you really?
Yes.
That's beautiful.
Two of them in case one runs out.
Yeah, who makes their own beer to keep up their own supply?
Who grows their own hops?
There you go.
I even grow my own hops.
Who grows their own weed?
No, they can't seize your house for growing hops.
That's true.
I would never. Dude, when they were putting the solar panels up on my crib.
Actually, got to be careful there because they're cousins. Hemp and hops are really close
cousins. Well, whatever. Kissing cousins.
Just
let
you know.
I just, it's never worth it. That's why I never understand those dudes that, you know, have the basement or whatever, because they get crazy now. They got like the thermal imaging and helicopters and...
Be smart. Plant it on the other side of the fence in the neighbor's yard.
Yeah, that.
I think I might try it at his house.
Big Wayne's going to plant it in Lazlow's yard.
I know his neighbors very well.
Excellent. Wayne already goes to grocery stores, and I get the weirdest stuff in the mail now because Wayne signs me up for everything he can find.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Every grocery store coupon.
I've signed him up for more magazine deliveries, everything. Every time I go, you know, you get these discount cards when you go into, like, you know, Genevieve's.
Yep.
Every one of them, I've been him.
Always sign your friends up, yeah. I do that, too.
Maternity magazine.
Because he knows that I don't, like, I get freaky about the whole grocery store things, so they track what you purchase and everything, and then now the federal government's buying a lot of those databases to look for terrorists for some strange reason. And so... Now, when they see my buying habits, I evidently eat a lot of pork chops, and What's the other weird stuff you're always buying? You go to the grocery store and spend more money than any human being I know.
Buys a lot of Dutch Masters.
But it has to last for 3 weeks.
He's going to...
Whoa.
What are you doing with the mic over there? Listen, this isn't with your 45s DJing at a wedding, man. No wonder you don't DJ at weddings anymore.
You go to the grocery store once every 3 weeks?
Once a month.
Once a month?
Yeah.
Dude, this ain't Little House on the Prairie.
Yeah.
But no.
What do you do, go to the general store?
That's it. Once a month, $400, $500, and you're good.
God, I live in the city. I go once a day.
Well, there's other days you have to go for, you know, milk and fruit or something like that. But basically, the big bulk comes in one day.
If you have a Whole Foods in your neighborhood, that's where the hottest chicks shop. Because those are the girls that are in shape and they're healthy and stuff like that. It's amazing. It's like a meat market in there.
See, and last year,
I'm in there for like 2 hours. I come out of it with like three things. Yeah, you wait till you see. Go to Whole Foods where you live. You'll see. It's unbelievable.
See, now, I can see that at Whole Foods, but it's like if you go to a regular sort of health food store, the chicks in there have hair under their armpits. It's not a good vibe at all. But Whole Foods is more of that, like, I'm a sort of a yuppie. I like to stay in shape. I've got a little dough.
Yeah.
You know.
You got, like, the housewives that are, like, 40 that, you know, the husband makes a lot and they have nothing better to
do. They're not going to, like, you know.
But they're hot.
Get mad at you because you don't juice and drag you to a Trey show. Anybody who know Trey?
Trey Anastasio?
Thank you. Okay. Oh. I was going to say.
Okay.
You ever been to a fish show?
No.
I walked out of the one fish show I went to. Walked out.
Is that bad or?
Yeah, it stunk. It was terrible. Up there playing a vacuum cleaner.
Because nobody uses deodorant or?
No, I just didn't get it. I didn't get it.
My right sweats more than my left. I haven't been able to figure that out.
How do you?
You nad?
No, this one will be dry and this one will be soaked.
Yeah, I've been pitting out for years.
Wait, when they're that close together, I really can't distinguish which one's sweating and which
one's. But just so you know, there is a left and a right, and one hangs a little
lower. I know
there's
a left and a right. Thanks.
Thanks for clearing that up.
Anatomy 101, Big Wayne.
Yeah, right. Thanks, Wayne. Exactly. You know, I asked people if they had any baby arm sightings to get in touch with us. We've had none.
Yeah, I think that's a hard one to fulfill.
Baby what sighting?
Wayne has a fetish for girls with disfigured arms.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I used to think that, you know, I used to tell a lot of people that I was small.
Right.
Okay, but after the porn chicks were here, it turns out that I'm not so bad, and I used to think that I wanted a little baby arm or a baby hand to make me feel very large.
Right.
Turns out maybe I don't need a baby hand, but I still entertain the thought.
So, but you've always sort of found disfigured people kind of attractive.
Yeah, there's something with that, sure. It's like if they're in a wheelchair, they can't get away from you.
You're right. Unless you move to the third floor.
Okay.
We had this porn producer in 2 weeks ago, and he gave us some videos that were traumatizing. Like, beyond normal porn. Just, like, stuff that maybe... your buddy, your old roommate used to be into?
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah, some bathroom stuff. Yeah.
Lots of bathroom stuff. Some of it ain't even in the bathroom.
It's just bad news. I was going to ask you, how did Club Soda Kenny, like, end up on these videos with you? How did you meet him?
I met him through Dice, through Andrew Dice Clay. Because me and Jim Norton met, we were big fans of Dice. We met him out in L.A. one time. And then when he came to New York to do some shows, we went to go see him. And Kenny worked for Dice for a long time. So, you know, we met him through there. And Kenny's, you know, lives in Jersey or whatever like that. We just became friends with him.
Oh, yeah, he's the nicest guy.
Was he originally, like, Dice's bodyguard? Or?
Yeah, he was bodyguard tour manager for, like, 20 years. He was there when he did the Meadowlands and the Garden and all that stuff.
I noticed at Babe Fest, when he comes backstage, he was just walks right up. He goes, is there anything you need? Anybody, and, you know, he was automatically watching over everybody.
Oh, yeah, he's amazing like that. He knows.
Great guy.
Yeah. So, yeah, but him and Wayne are like the two most undiscovered talents on the face of the planet. Both of those guys should have their own show, seriously. Two of the funniest guys I've ever seen. They don't even know they're funny. They just are. They don't even have to try.
When you were doing that bit at the Chinese all-you-can-eat thing, I was dying with Club Soda Kenny going, what do you think, mister?
Yeah, mister, what do you think? I can fill my bucket up, my peach pail bucket with the food?
Well, that one where you're going through the grocery store and you're putting stuff in other people's carts.
Oh, I love doing that.
And then Club Soda Kenny walks by and yells at the lady, what are you putting that back for? Wait, she was taking the stuff out of the cart because she didn't know what it was.
Yeah, she's like, it doesn't go there. She goes, that guy put it in. What guy? There's no guy.
He starts yelling at her. It's priceless.
He's such a troublemaker. It's great.
Yeah, every time I hang out with him, he, you know, we'll be like backstage at something, or when Wayne and I were and Reed were at the party that Opie and Anthony had for Halloween, he's always doing that trick of like, hey, Mrs., you drop something.
You drop something, yeah.
That's his, like, static thing. He does it, like, once an hour. And it works every time.
It works because he has such that voice. You drop something.
So how many Meet the Creeps things has he been on with you?
No, he's on a bunch on Comedy Central, probably about 3 out of 10 that we're doing, and he's on probably about 8 or 9 on a new DVD that's coming out in about a month.
But there's one Meet the Creeps already.
There's one, and there's going to be another one coming out in less than a month, probably.
And you can buy all that at your website.
Yeah, jimflorentine.com. And Kenny's also doing stand-up comedy Thursday night at the Laugh Factory.
In New York City?
In New York City. There's a whole cringe humor show. I'm on Nick DiPaolo, Club Soda Kenny, I think Robert Kelly. There's a bunch of us, but Club Soda's going up to like 5 minutes.
Let's do it.
You got to see his stand-up. It is so funny. Well, he'll just do it around people. Like, I'll say, hey, Kenny, tell Lazlow about your marriage, and he'll just go in there, and he has the most brutal jokes I've ever heard in my life.
I hear him on O&A.
They are awful. Oh, I mean, they're just horrendous. Meaning just so... there's no reason for the jokes that he says. Not that they're that bad, but it's beautiful. And the audience is going to just boo him, or they're just going to stare at him. He doesn't care.
That's this Thursday?
Yeah.
Wow. And how much, do you know how much the show is? Is there a website?
I guess cringehumor.net.
All right.
Or whatever. But the Laugh Factory, right across from the Port Authority in New York City.
I don't take public transportation.
But whatever, it's 40. No, it used to be the old.
Just kidding.
It used to be the old Show World. I'm sure Wayne.
I know Show World.
Yeah, exactly.
I still have a coin here on my keys from Show World.
Do you really?
Yes, I do.
Show World was the greatest place ever.
A coin?
Why was Show World?
It was a peep show, and they had live girls in there.
What does that do?
Oh, this is the...
when you went in, you had to exchange your money for coins to go into the peep shows.
Now, why was that? So you would put slugs in?
No, so they, you know, you had to have their money so they could actually, you know, kind of keep you in the place.
Show palace.
Oh, so it's like when you go to a like an arcade.
You've been, Jim, huh?
Ben, please.
I've been thrown out.
I left my sneakers in there because they were stuck to the ground.
I told them about the stickiness in there.
Oh, it's awful. I know.
There was a strong smell in there, too. Do you remember what the smell was?
The Clorox?
Yeah, I called it ammonia.
Yeah, same thing, yeah. But it's great because they would just yell, you drop them, we mop them.
That's right.
That was their motto.
Wow, and
that brings back memories.
That's great.
I was in
but
there.
There's a whole system to doing that, like, because they had the live girls on one side. You don't want to spend too much money over there. So what you do is you go into the video ones, you warm up like you're warming up in the bullpen.
I don't need to warm up anymore.
Really?
I need to get right to the action.
No, but you don't want to spend too much money with the live ones. So you go in there, you get ready. You know, a pitcher doesn't come in and just start firing. Mariano Rivera goes in the pen and warms up a little bit.
You got a point.
So you go into film ones first, you warm up a little bit, then you go to the live girls.
See, but I've never been to one of these places. Is it like the Madonna video? That's my only...
Yeah.
Yes. Without a doubt.
So
I will see your face on the other side of the room when the curtain comes up.
Yeah, that's
up.
A little creepy.
Yes, it is.
There's all these windows open. You can see some creepy guy across from you looking.
Because when old faces go on, it's not your normal face.
You can see the guy on the other side?
Yes.
Some of them, yeah. In that place, you could. Yeah, because all these little windows.
Because it was a circle. It was actually
a
big circle.
It was just a circle, yeah.
Oh, I don't want to see that.
Oh, it was scary.
You know what? Yeah, you're in a battle there. You know, it's like you're in a foxhole. You got to do what you got
to
do.
And you're trying to time it so right because, you know, the curtain starts coming down. You're not done. You're like, damn, another coin. The curtain goes back up.
Well, there was one down in Philly, like somewhere around Philly or South Jersey, where they had like a timer on there. So, you know how much time you had left.
Oh, so Show World didn't have time.
Yeah, I know. They didn't have the timers, which was great. So it was like beat the clock.
Exactly. Beat the clock.
We called it beep the Pope.
Beat the Bishop. I've missed out on so much in life. We didn't have these things.
Jim, I actually did that cutting out from high school. That's what we did. We wouldn't go to high school to decide, let's go to 42nd Street for the day, you know, and start off with the peep shows. And then eventually you worked your way up to, the testicles to go to a live, you know, show.
Absolutely, yeah. They didn't care if you were 16. Yeah, we used to take the train in from Jersey, go to the peep shows, and they'd just go drink in a bar. We'd always find, like, some little old man bar they would serve us at 16.
Exactly.
It was great.
What was it with those old man bars? They just did not
care. They didn't care.
Yeah, that was the great, yes.
It was just like, I'm old, whatever.
No, they're trying to keep up with the big guys. They got to take the money where they can get it.
Well, and also, I mean, you know, those old guys used to be able to drink at 18. You know? I mean, we've, like, changed it to 21.
I made the grandfather clause. Actually, my brother made the grandfather clause in D.C. So when I was 17, I'd just steal his ID and go up to D.C. and drink.
Beautiful. Why? Well,
you had to be 18. And then they changed it. But as long as you were 18 before they changed the rule, you were fine. You could still go back and drink.
It's because it's the war on fun in this country.
Yeah, well,
They, in Jersey, they, you didn't have to have a picture ID. So my brother was 5 years older than me. So I used to use his. We had duplicate copies. So I was 16, getting the gloves at 21. It was beautiful.
Did I tell you about what happened to my fake ID? My fake ID was not only taken, they started using it at presentations that they would make at schools.
Oh, wow.
And they would have these huge, like, slideshows where they were telling kids about, you know, how bad it is to drink and all this, and how people, you know, use fake IDs and you can get into big trouble. And it was when I was in college, and I guess they were showing this. You had to go to this obligatory presentation if you were in frats or whatever. I had some buddies that were in this one frat that was notorious for dealing and all sorts of other stuff. And they were in this huge auditorium, and my fake ID popped up there. And all these people chanted, Lazlow!
That's great.
It was bad.
But who confiscated the ID?
It was a guy at the at a bar. He confiscated it because there were suddenly, I mean, this, we live in, you know, the school was in Missouri, his college is in Missouri, and all of a sudden, everybody in town's from Tennessee.
Okay.
You know, because in my dorm, the guy had the big poster board.
You stand behind it.
Yeah, the big poster board, very intricately designed, and you stood basically, yeah, behind it. And they took a picture, and they cut it out, and they had a laminating, it was a whole operation, they made a ton of money.
And what did you pay for that?
I think I traded. I did a little guns and butter marijuana.
My dorm was like 10, 15 bucks.
Mine was 10 bucks, and it was on 42nd Street.
Oh, you got it on?
That's where you got them. You got them right on. Everything happened on 42nd Street before Giuliani turned the whole system around.
I hate Giuliani.
It sucks to be a kid now, because, I mean, technology, it's advanced. You can't do the cardboard cutout anymore.
Yeah.
They have the thing where you swipe it.
Oh, I know. They've got, like, holographs, and, like, Princess Leia pops up and says, help me, Obi-Wan. It's a whole scene.
Yeah, and then we used to always stand outside the liquor store and have someone come buy it. Can you buy us a case of beer? They don't do that stuff no more.
I still get hit with that, Jim.
You do?
I do it for the young guys.
No, I would too, absolutely.
That's how I started.
I only got it once, you know what I mean? But guys,
my wife wants to shoot me when she says, you're going to get caught one day. This is what I tell the kids. I'm going to get it.
You're giving back to the community.
Right? I'm giving back to the community. Anheuser-Busch loves me.
You're helping a kid out.
The sad part is when I was a kid, you went in and you asked for, like, you know, a six pack. So the one night I'm going up and these kids say to me, hey, mister, can you get me some beer? Now, first of all, he called me mister. Right. Already, like, hold on. But I said to him, yeah, okay. And they go, like, well, we want 5 40s of, like, OE. We want, like, 22-ounce Coronas. And I'm like, hold on, fellas. You're getting one thing here. Tell me one order. I'll come out whatever you want. But I'm not going in, like, a shopping list.
12 cases and a keg.
Well, they pretty much went for the two cases. And that was it.
I was like,
but when
I
came out, now I'm getting a little paranoid. I think, oh, I can't be seen handing this over to some young. So I said, I'm going to go in my car. I'm going to go two blocks. I'm going to pull over. I'll be there. And I'm not going to rip them off, and they do it.
That's great.
Yeah, that's how I started.
And look at you now, Wayne. A model of society. Airing your...
Hey, listen, I'm a friend of yours.
True. I just love hanging out with Wayne in public because everybody stares at him because of his dreadlock beard. And I can't wait till he goes to Jamaica because he's skipping out on Christmas because Christmas sucks now.
Yes.
And he's going to go to the homeland.
The homeland. And I'm going to go through two in the first day, Jim.
Yeah?
Yes.
You bringing the wife?
Yeah. One for her and one for me.
She smokes too?
Oh, yes.
He's bringing a case of Dutch Masters, mm-hmm. Literally.
Now you're not going to bring the stuff back? And
oh, no. I'm good on that. I don't need to go to spend any time in prison. I enjoy it too much. You can't get it in prison.
Right.
No, at least not for free.
Yeah, you'll get something else in prison.
Yeah, I'm sure.
No, I knew it's a long story, but I lived in such a bad neighborhood. The guy next to me was on the run from shooting a cop, and he was a Crip and blah, blah, blah. But he was in the joint for a while, and he said that the amount that they buy in prison is basically the cap of a... like lip balm or something, or chapstick.
For how much?
You bought a ton of money, dude, to sneak that stuff into prison.
That's not even a hit, is it, Wayne?
No. No. Sometimes I ask a certain friend if he could front me a little batch, no names mentioned. And the batch he gives me kind of is like, all right, I'll accept it, but it's not a full Dutch Master. Hey, you don't know where I'm going with that, do you?
No, I really don't. This is the Lazlow Show. We'll be back in just a bit with Jim Florentine, and we have some other stuff to get to that I can't seem to find at the moment.
More talk about Christmas trees.
93KROQ. It is the Lazlow Show. Website's lazlow.com. You can see pictures of Big Wayne surrounded by porn starlets. And, oh, I got to take a picture of Florentine in the studio.
Yeah, too bad there's no porn chicks here.
Jim Florentine, comedian who will be performing this Thursday at what place?
The Laugh Factory in New York City.
Laugh Factory.
And then Friday, Saturday, Sunday this week, Rascals in Nyack, New York, which is where that big mall is, I guess, by the Tappan Zee
Bridge.
Didn't
Bill Burr just did,
did he?
Rascals, I think. I don't know. He was on.
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, so I'll be there Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
And
yeah.
December 15th, you'll be at the Electric Factory in Philadelphia.
That's right.
Wow, that's a good venue.
Yeah, I've done that one a few times.
Our holiday comedy spectacular on ice.
I've done the show with Cousin Ed's Babe Fest. And yeah, I was on one. Then you're like, yeah, do some stand up. He's like, how much are you going to do? I go, I'm just maybe 5-10 minutes. He's like, you could do more if you want. Not in front of that crowd.
I did
like 3 minutes.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I'm like, all right, Ed, you ready?
And I think the only thing that held him at that point is because we had a picture of Special Ed up on the screen for a minute. It's like, all right, Ed, doesn't matter what he's saying, but we know who he is. Yeah!
That was a rough crowd. There was chicks coming out, taking their tops off, and they were throwing drinks at them.
I get hit with quarters, like, literally. I leave that place with bruises. People just start throwing everything.
Animals.
I pick up the money, though. I usually leave with, like, $32. The girls ain't getting it.
No, I didn't say nothing that. I'll let Gene Simmons make all the comments that night.
Exactly. Yeah. Dude, I got this invite to all these, when a video game comes out, you know, I'll get an invite or the new mobile phone. I actually got invited to the debut of some new games for mobile phones. NBC is advertising a game for your mobile phone about figure skating.
What?
So, if I ever see anybody playing this, I'm going to beat them upside the head. But first off, figure skating.
Well, if Nancy Kerrigan's in it, you have to chase her around and beat her ass.
Figure skating is the dumbest.
If you're going to beat somebody up, it's going to be gay bashing if they're playing that game.
Find the lead pole.
It's ruined the Olympics. They can't have any of the cool Winter Olympics or any of that because they're always showing the stupid figure skating, which is like a sissy. And a girl who's anorexic spinning in circles. Well, yippee.
Every time we go up to British Columbia, they always have the curling. And everybody at the airport is just like glued to the TV. Shh, they're curling.
Do you know what curling is?
No, I don't watch the
Olympics. It's like shuffleboard is it ice?
Yes, it's like this big rubber thing. I'm sure Reed knows.
And they have one guy that like pushes. I've curled. They push
you. Have you?
Sure, yeah.
Were you the pusher or were you the sweeper?
No, you're the pusher. There was no sweeper.
Were you the top or the bottom?
Jim, basically, there's a long pole with this puck, or a large puck, and somebody pushes it. And as it's sliding, there's like four people in front of it with brooms, like wiping in front of the puck so it'll go farther.
It is the dumbest thing I've seen. And you actually made fun of it. I was doing an interview on a Minneapolis rock station, and I was doing a quick interview, and I made a goof about curling, and they like went off on me, like, dude, a lot of us do that up here. I'm like, you're idiots.
Why?
Reed, I have to know about please. Why.
Well, I did it for a magazine story, but I went to this curling club in New Jersey. And,
did you have to put all your car keys in a bowl?
Things got out of hand there, didn't it?
Yeah.
Were there people, were Three Musketeers flying?
Yeah, it was just like that porn shoot, wasn't it? Just crazy.
It was, only the people were much older and more bundled up. But it was actually pretty fun, you know. You guys can be down on it all you want, but it's a big stone. It's like literally a stone, and it's got a handle on top of it, and you slide it down the ice, and you try to land the stone on a bullseye. And then when your opponent lands the stone on a bullseye, you can take your stone and knock his out like billiards or something.
Right, or you could be like a real caveman and pick it up and conk him on the head with it and say, you stupid faggot, why are you playing this game, and split.
What do you got against winter sports, dude?
That's fun.
Dude, I don't know, man.
Fun to me is hanging out in the champagne room at a strip club. Yeah. Not chasing a rock.
Dude, winter sports to
me is
snowboarding, you know? I'm sorry, but like sweeping the ice furiously and drinking Molson Golden and going a lot is just lame.
I want to just get a Zamboni.
I want you to crush Jim's self-esteem and say yes here. Are there curling groupies?
For me, you mean?
No, for anybody. I can see, like, oh, the girls are hot for the champion groupie or the guy who's the curler winner.
No, but they say it's huge because a few years ago it was dying, and most of the people who were playing it were sort of dying off because they were in their 60s or whatever. And then it was on the Olympics, and it's like one of the highest rated sports on the Olympics. So they got all these young people showing up wanting to curl. Wow. It's hot now.
Country.
See, I only watch the Special Olympics because everybody wins. Everybody goes home with a trophy. You know what I mean?
You let them curl. I'd watch that.
How did your How did your protest show? You were doing some stand-up comedy, and there was going to be some retards in the front row.
Yeah.
Did
They never showed up.
They never showed up?
No.
I got confused. They couldn't find the place.
No, what happened was I was doing this college up in Buffalo, and it was a private Catholic school, and they were going to protest the show because they had a picture of me and a puppet up. You know, I was coming to school, and they were going to cancel a show, or whatever. And then when I got there, I guess one of the professors teaches special ed kids on the side, and she said, "I'm going to bring all my special ed students. They're going to sit in the front two rows of his comedy show." So when I get there, the guy who booked me there is freaking out. He's like, "She's going to bring the special ed kids. They're going to sit right in the front row." Oh my god! I go, "Good." I go, "They laugh at anything." You know what I mean? I'll record a CD tonight. They'll be laughing at the setups. They didn't show up. No, it was fine.
That's a shame. How many religious institutions have you done?
I don't do colleges because they're so politically correct, but this kid was, I don't know, he booked it and he saw me at a comedy club up there and wanted to have me there. No, because they're all babies, these kids. I've done like these NACA conventions, you know what I mean, where they pick the college kids go around and they pick out talent to get booked, and they're so politically correct. I did one like in Oklahoma, in Tulsa.
Oh.
I did one about 3 weeks ago and they hated me. I emceed the show and everything. They were just groaning at everything.
What has happened to
you? Because they want you to be so clean. Like, he has to be clean, right? And I was doing a joke. I said, "Yeah, I have a small penis," right? It was like halfway through my set. And some, yes, I do. But some girl that, you know, is booking a talent that wants me to be clean, she goes, "Yeah, I can tell." That's what she yells out at the show. It wasn't even like just a comedy club girl that was drunk. So it's like, this is the girl that's telling me I got to be clean. And she goes, "Yeah, I could tell." So then I couldn't just leave it at that. I go, "Well, we'll see if you could tell when it's in your mouth later tonight." And later, my agent's like, "You probably lost about $30,000 in school because of that comment." I go, "You know what? It was worth it." Because she came by the booth afterwards. It's almost like you're a prostitute. They come by the booth and they pick out the talent. Like, so you perform, then you got to stand at a booth right after the show and go, "Oh, pick me, did you like me?" It's awful. I feel like a hooker over in Amsterdam, you know, in a window. And she came over, she's really? Yelling, she's like, "You're offensive, we're not booking you, or we're not booking any of your people on your roster." So my freaking agent's freaking out. "You're ruining work for everybody." I go, "Look, man, she come back with that, I'm saying stuff."
You ever have a girl in Amsterdam?
No.
No.
I was there on a 6-hour layover when I did Kuwait. And we got there like 7 in the morning, me and the other comedian. He just wanted to get a hooker. That was his main goal. I said,
"Okay. Take the train right in from the airport."
That's what we did. Yeah. So we had the layover. What happened was we went to one of those cafes or those diners or whatever, and he had some hash cake. He goes, "Why don't you take a piece?" I'm like, "Yeah." He's like, "Yeah, just a little piece." I had a little piece.
Flying.
First 30 minutes was great, and then I flipped out. I thought I was going to die.
That's the thing about
the guy had to talk me down and stuff, like walk me around the whole Amsterdam for 4 hours. He couldn't get a hooker. He was so mad. We got back on the plane. He was so mad at me because he had to just walk me around and babysit me because I thought I was going to die. I was freaking out.
If you OD eating weed, it's like there'll be people in the fetal position on a park bench that you'll see because they just ate too much because it takes so long for it to kick in. People are like, I'll eat some more. And then it kicks in and they're just out of their, they've like, it's the equivalent of smoking like 15 joints.
First time I made pot brownies, that's what I did. I ate it. An hour later, I was like, "Well, this isn't so bad. Let's eat another one." Next thing you know, it's 8 hours later, I'm playing the same video game. I haven't moved. Okay.
Well, that's good.
Good stuff.
At least you weren't in the fetal position.
Yeah, and I don't even do that stuff. So it was like, totally hit me and I was freaking out.
What were you freaking out about? What were you thinking about?
I remember being in a diner and I'm like, I want, give me one of those bananas over there. And the woman's like, "There's no bananas there." I'm like, "They're right there. Why isn't so what? Because I'm American, you won't give me a banana?" I'm like, freaking screaming, like, "You got to get him out of here."
I had a bit of a scene.
But, you know, the friend was, he was a good friend because he walked me around. He didn't get his hooker. And I felt bad on the long flight home, so I gave him a hand release on the plane. You know what I mean? I had to. I didn't look, so I wasn't gay. I didn't look him in the eye.
I had a bit of a freak out when we went into this nice restaurant. And right beforehand, my buddy and I ate some of the same thing, whatever, the hash cake. And we go in, and, I mean, it really starts kicking in. And I'm sort of hallucinating a little bit. And there's this woman who's sitting at the table next to us, who's talking, and I start to convince myself that she's talking about me somehow, and I lean over to her, and I look at her, and I go, "Did you just call me gay?" And she's like, "Excuse me?" I go, "I think you just called me gay." And she's like, "I have no idea what you're talking about." I'm like, "I'll be honest, I don't either. I'm a little whacked at the moment." And it was me and my buddy and his friend's completely straight edge. And he just had his head in his hands. He was like, "Oh, these guys are whacked."
Do you have a banana?
Do you have a banana?
I could have, they were there. I saw them. I saw them.
I might have booked my vacation to the wrong place. I should have gone to Amsterdam.
You should check
you
it out.
You and your wife can get a hooker over there.
You would need more Dutch Masters.
Might have to switch to a different brand.
Yeah, maybe like some kind of fancy European brand.
Sure.
There was, speaking of European, they're starting to track people who are smoking, you know, because like some of these companies now are getting so, even in America, like you can't smoke on the property at all. There's a big company, Computer Associates, that's on Long Island. You cannot smoke in your car on the grounds of the place. They don't want anybody who works for them smoking.
People throw their cigarette butts out the window.
Yeah, true. But, I mean, you're in your car. You know what I mean? But, it's you know, it's on their property. But there's this one German company that's now it actually, if anybody photographs somebody that works at the company smoking, they want them to turn it in, and they'll fire them.
For smoking.
Because you're supposed to sign this thing when you work there. It's a company called Laserline, they have a rigorous health and fitness program for the staff. And you're supposed to sign a thing saying that you won't start smoking while you work there. And if you get caught smoking a cigarette, you get fired.
Meanwhile, Philip Morris, if you work for that company, they give you a pack of cigarettes every day when you punch in.
Honestly?
Yeah, I swear to God, I was just down in Richmond, Virginia a couple months ago, and people at work at Philip Morris, they give you a pack a day. That's beautiful.
Yeah.
Reed, you got the gang signs going over here.
Yeah, what's
No, I grew up in Richmond, Virginia, and when we were in fifth grade, that was one of the things we used to do was take a tour of Philip Morris. And,
free pack.
I swear they would take the bus. If you were 16 at the end of the tour, you got a free pack of cigarettes.
That rules.
Yeah, it was back in the early 80s, 70s.
My favorite was the candy cigarettes. Those were the greatest. They were just like, pretty soon these will be real, buddy. Right now you'll get a little sugar buzz, but I mean, it's like, you can't even find them anymore.
No.
They're so not politically correct.
I used to steal my mom. My mom used to smoke Virginia Slims, those long ones, those women ones. They didn't even come in a hard pack.
Right.
That's how gay they were. But I took a liking to them, so I used to always steal her cigarettes because she smoked a lot or whatever. And I'd be out in the club. I didn't want to even bring them out. I'd keep them in my sock. You know what I mean? Anyway, you got a cigarette? Nah, I don't have one. I'd go in the bathroom in the stall, light it up, come out. They're like, where'd you get that cigarette? I go, some chick just gave it to me. I know. I don't even know what it is. Some fag cigarette. I'd hide it from everybody and just keep it in my sock the whole time.
Remember the little Capri ones? They were smaller.
Oh,
yeah. They looked like joints when you smoked them.
They came to do you remember the people that hand out samples at grocery stores? In Oklahoma, there would be people handing out samples of cigarettes, and like entire packs. And those Capri, when those came out, I worked at a grocery store, and the sample woman gave us like a couple of cartons of it. And I was like, oh, this is a cool job. You get like free stuff. So I found out what company she worked for, and I signed up to be a sample guy.
You got free Capris?
Well, sometimes you're standing there and spraying cheese on crackers. And other times it's cookies.
Wine coolers.
Never gave away any wine coolers.
Wine coolers and Capris, they go together.
Wine coolers are great for like white trash chicks. You know what I mean? If you're going in the store to get wine coolers, you know you had some chick in the car that had like big Bon Jovi hair or something like that. You know what I mean? The stretch jeans on.
Oh.
The boots outside of them.
Leopard skin.
Bleach.
Yeah.
No, the bleach jeans, right? Or acid washed.
Smoked through the Marlboro Lights or Newports.
I was a menthol sick smoker, as I worked with a lot of brothers, and we all, you know, I just got hooked on them.
I don't think you ever worked with brothers.
How many
brothers did you work with?
That's where I bought a 9. I bought a 9mm.
You knew one brother. They called him Token.
I stopped smoking menthols when I started working with the brothers, because they would always bum them. And the soft packs, you ever notice they would always open the soft pack
upside down,
yep. Which I never understood.
Yeah, why is that?
I don't know. I just said I don't understand it.
It was explained to me that they kept them in their pocket. It looked like a full pack, and they're like, I didn't open this pack yet.
Ah, brilliant.
Yeah.
Gosh, they're smart.
We just did a bit on Meet the Creeps on Comedy Central where we were going outside, people smoking outside of Manhattan. And we go, excuse me, can I get a bum a cigarette from you? Okay, yeah, no problem. They give me a cigarette. I light it up and take one drag, stamp it right out of their feet.
That's great.
Can I get another one? And meanwhile, I had one in my mouth and one behind each ear. They're like, yeah, it's just for later. Can you just fill my pack up? We got this Chinese guy. We got him like 14 cigarettes. Let me get one more. No, man, come on. Well, one more. One light, stamp it right out of his feet. Come on, just one more. Come on, man.
I only like them when they're fresh.
It's just for later.
And like you used to be able to give people cigarettes, you know? It didn't used to be that big of a deal, but they're like $8 a pack. Now it's like, dude, you're asking for some, you know,
I'm not giving a stranger 75 cents.
For $5, you get the American Spirit ones.
Oh, yeah. I know. All the hippie chicks smoke that.
Like, oh, the money goes to the Indians. No, they don't.
Speaking of black people, there was a guy... you were.
No, you were.
There was a guy... have you ever done any stand-up in Utah?
No.
Utah.
I got booked there one time, and then they found out I worked on Crank Yankers, and I did prank calls and these politically incorrect characters, and they canceled my show like two nights before.
Utah is a scary, scary place. There was a real estate developer there called Eagle Mountain that on their ads, they said that their area had the lowest percentage of blacks in the state. This is on the real estate ads. It's a Utah County community called Eagle Mountain, full of young families, new homeowners, and white people. The website of the home builder, Big Homes, had this comparison among others, quote, black race population percentage significantly below state average, unquote, and significantly below was in bold. But, I mean, a place where basically the Mormons run the government in the place. Like, you can't... There's certain areas of town you can't drink soda. Have you heard that?
No.
Yeah, you can't drink soda. It's an weird anti-Mormon thing. I swear to God. On like the campuses?
They can't have caffeine, but do you know that the Mormon church is like the major stockholder of Pepsi?
It all comes down to the money.
So they've made an exception now, and if you're Mormon, you can drink Pepsi.
It's good.
Yeah. Jesus.
But not Coke.
But not Coke.
I don't know. I tried to go snowboarding there, and half of the places, you can't even snowboard. I'm like, dude, is this 1802?
Wait, where's this Jackson Hole? Where are we going? That's in Wyoming, though. Yes, we're cool, right?
Yes.
I don't want to go to some dry state. What snowboarding
you
can't
drink? It's so weird that there's still parts of this country that you cannot buy alcohol.
Like Sunday morning or something like that.
Well, no, I'm talking about it all. In Texas, there's tons of dry.
Well, Ocean County. City, New Jersey is a dry county or something like that.
And they don't like it when you bring it across.
Across,
you know, the county line, state lines. It's illegal. You can't go buy liquor where it is not dry and bring it to a dry place. They don't like that at all.
Who's they?
The man, you know. The cops.
Right. Police. Can you get in trouble? I mean, is it like fireworks?
Yes, you can get in trouble. That's what I'm saying.
Is it a fine or is it you go to jail?
I haven't gotten caught. I don't know. I don't even leave Philadelphia. I just have to come to this stupid show. You got to pay $60 just to get here for what?
Well, we thought we might have a future.
Yes. Got to be very careful when I talk about that stuff right now. So
why?
Got to keep all your feelers out. You know, everybody's my friend right now.
Yeah. Why? You talking to people?
No, I'm not talking to anybody. Nobody wants to talk to me.
Everybody I know went to the magical place that has birds in the sky.
I don't know if they could pay me enough to keep up my lifestyle. So, but then again, come January 1st, I may not have a choice.
Why is it January 1st?
Doesn't stuff go down on that January 1st? I don't know.
No.
No?
It goes down whenever it goes down.
Well, I think January 3rd.
You got to be ready.
Yeah.
Never know what's going to happen.
Well, Wayne might have a gig, you know. He could be David Lee Roth's sidekick.
Hey.
He probably still smokes. You know what I mean?
I'm sure he does.
Yeah.
I should play this. I was doing some research. We always play mashups on the show. And I found the very first mashup, according to mashup historians. Any guess what year it came out? Ed?
68.
No. 1978.
How do we know it's the first one?
Huh? Because mashup historians have figured it out.
And who are these people?
A bunch of stone DJs.
That's the guy who's writing Reed a postcard letters.
Know it yet?
I know what the first song is.
Just turn right back and you'll hear a tale of a fateful trip that started from this tropic port aboard this tiny ship. The mate was a mighty sailing man, the skipper brave and sure. Five passengers set sail that day for a three-hour tour, a three-hour tour. wife, the movie star.
Is the Lazlow Show, episode 21. Running out of show, but his cousin Ed has to leave at 9:30.
Yeah, I got to leave at 9:30 too.
Oh, great.
We're going to the bar. See you later, bye.
Where are you going? You going to do some stand-up?
No, I got to... I'm on like 2 hours sleep just getting from Pittsburgh, so I got to get up early.
Dude, that's like an hour flight.
Yeah, but when you're out till 4 a.m. drinking.
What were you doing?
Please. He's like, what is he doing?
What are you, his mother?
I was doing Jaeger bombs and everything else.
Wayne wants to bring in a bottle of absinthe and drink it on the air, which I think is a bad idea because it makes you really slow and stupid. Have you ever?
No.
And that's going to affect me.
It doesn't really slow you down. It makes you stupid. It makes you crazy.
It makes me a little hallucinogenic. All the lights are
getting
bright.
You've done it already?
There's a line there.
I bought a bottle and I was in Prague earlier this year.
How come you don't turn a brother on to this?
Because it's, you know.
Wait, what color was it? Was it green stuff? Because now there's a lot of fake stuff out
there.
I know.
No, dude, I bought the one with Van Gogh on the front. Okay. The nice one.
Okay.
The one that's like $75.
I just love when I meet these people. Yeah, we did absinthe. It was red. Or they're like, I did 8 shots of it. It wasn't absinthe.
You'd be dead.
Yeah.
I did 2 shots, and I was wandering around Prague. Like, this map made no sense. Everything was jumping off the page. It was loaded.
You do 8 shots of absinthe. You think you're playing Grand Theft Auto, then you wake up the next morning and realize, no, that really happened.
Yeah, exactly.
There was 8 cops after me, and I ran over 12 people. And
you ever had absinthe?
No, I haven't.
Evidently, Ed hangs out with some absinthe junkies down in...
Ed knows everybody in Philly.
And we were doing it in a bar. I was telling Wayne, I said, it looked like... I felt guilty first time I did it because I thought people were looking because it looks like you're doing heroin. You got the spoon, the sugar, and the flame.
Yeah, you like that. You put the sugar up on top, and then you light it, and it, like, drips down.
Once it crystallizes, yeah, then you stir it in, then you do the shot.
Evidently, Reed Tucker's had a little absinthe...
I would like to see Reed.
Was that before or after curling?
Crazy. That's where he got it from, his curling friend.
Improve my score. No, I got a couple bottles in the pantry at home.
A couple bottles?
The pantry? From Prague.
Holding out.
What? Am I supposed to tell you that when I first meet you?
Yes, I have absinthe.
Okay. Ed, I have absinthe.
If I had it, I'd tell you. I don't, but I will soon. All
right. Really?
That's great. You get a chick drunk on 1 shot of it?
Yeah, it's like doing 5 shots of tequila in a bong hit.
Yeah. Not perfect.
Never done that.
But I'm willing to try.
That's what I read on the internet.
Wayne, did you ever have sex with a girl after she threw up?
Yes.
Jesus. Florentine is in love with him. You're in love with Wayne.
Yes, it's actually my wife.
And it was last night.
No, but it was in the beginning part of the relationship. Right. Yes.
Remember, I tried to bang my wife on our wedding night after she threw up. In fact, me trying to bang her is probably what made her throw up in the first place. So
on a wedding night?
Yeah.
She threw up?
She was taking the dress off. And I was like, I'm going to consummate the marriage. Next thing you know, get off me. You're making me sick. And it was like 8 hours of puke after that.
And it was all downhill from there.
Mm-hmm.
But she looked good in those little schoolgirl outfits. You know, our buddy Doogie had a fetish for her.
Yeah. He can have her now.
Yeah, like, you know, it happens.
Have my leftovers, right?
You know, it's great after a girl pukes. You don't have to make out with them.
That's true.
You know what I mean?
Oh, you don't?
No. You still make out with your wife?
Sure.
You're sick. Unless
you're doing shotguns, right?
No. Jim, I got to say, when I was younger, I got action right away. Now that I'm older, I'm looking forward to things that are like happening in high school, just long grinding sessions, makeout sessions. She really don't want to participate, but she does.
You want to pretend like you're in high school again and make out.
Because back in high school, I got it. And then I realized that the tease is sometimes, you know, part of the challenge.
Man, my wife hated the foreplay. No, I have to be on top. Lights
out. She's the only one that hated foreplay. They all love foreplay.
Not this one. Uh-uh. I guess it was so grueling for her. She's like, let's get it over with. Just leave the lights off and my shirt on.
Right. I'd be partying with Ed.
Ed, I want to hit a certain size. What was her weight? Because the fat ones usually like the shirts on and lights are off.
Yeah.
See, Jim knows.
The only light they like on is the refrigerator light.
Exactly.
She wasn't fat. She was one of those ones that thought she was. She was like 5'4 and, I don't know, 125.
That ain't bad.
What's the fattest girl you ever been with, Wayne?
About 160.
That's not bad, dude. I was with a sorority girl that was just enormous.
Yeah, well.
She was a
I was never
high
desperate.
Kappa Phi.
Was it a bet you lost, or...?
No, I was just young and disillusioned. No, you know what it was? She was rich, and she bought me. She showered me with liquor and beer.
Fat chicks are known to do that, though.
So you were drunk, or you felt like you owed her?
Hmm.
Were you drunk, or you felt like you owed her because she bought you drinks?
No, I just, you know, what it was is I was sort of a punk rocker, and then I went off to college. And I was sort of saying, well, maybe I should move on, you know, from the Mohawk stage.
She was the first one in college?
Yeah, pretty much.
Yep.
Mm. And you know, she liked, because, you know, I had, like, the leather jacket with the chains and the studs and all that kind of stuff. And she liked to bring me to her dopey sorority things like she was hardcore or something. And then I got tired of her and kicked her to the curb.
After you had sex the first time?
Huh?
You did more than once?
So, sure. Dude, she would bring me beer to work. I would call her and I'd be like, bring me a six-pack.
Because
I was 17 when I went into college.
I don't buy this last call. So bring me a six-pack.
Fat girls
will
do anything.
You're like,
maybe on your way. Fat girls will do anything.
Yeah, I know that.
Fat girls like me with a good-looking girl. Like, what do you need? Yes, I'll bring it for you. I'm going to make you cookies. Okay, sure.
Yeah. She'll do anything but eat an egg white omelet. But I remember my first fat girl. We were down at this bar in Florida, and my brothers were there. And, there was this huge girl sitting across the bar, and what they were doing, they were sending her drinks. They told the bartender, send her drinks and say it was for me.
Oh.
Yes.
So this girl is smiling at me across the bar, like, oh my, like, she's looking at me like I'm a cheeseburger, basically, the whole night. And like, wow, look at that girl checking out. So now she's sending them over to me. And it's like that girl right there. I'm like, hey, thanks, whatever. Next thing I know, I'm like 12 shots deep, 10 beers. You know, I have no idea this is going on. They're like, she really likes you. Me and my brother's doing this behind my back. I go, hey, I go over there, I start talking. I go, you want to take a walk out in the parking lot?
How romantic.
Yeah, of course. We went in the bushes, did our thing, went back in, and she's like, you know, call me or whatever. I'm like, yeah, absolutely. I was living down there at the time. Of course, I never did. A month later, I run into her at another bar. She's like, are you Jim? I put an English accent on. I'm like, this is my first day in the country. Whatever it was, it was awful.
That's not a very good accent.
It was awful. She's like, no, you were at the playpen that night. I go, I don't know what you're talking about. This is my first day in the country. She's like, you weren't there. Your brothers were. I go, I don't even have a brother.
And then
she knew I was lying, though.
What did you say?
And then she introduced you to your son.
Right.
This is
Little Jim.
Probably.
Jim Florentine.
Well, I couldn't tell if she was pregnant when I saw her a month later.
See, my new cousin, right. She just punched her in the stomach for good measure. When Cousin Ed was supposed to have my back when he and I would be hanging out at Malibu down in Lido Beach, the infamous club.
Oh,
we'd be broadcasting live there on WDRE, the Underground Network.
Back.
Dude, you let me make out with a fat chick. And then it was so bad that the next time we were there, because we got free drinks from the place, we're backstage doing all sorts of various and sundry drugs. And there was the next time we were there, this big fat chick came up to me, and she's like, hey, Lazlow. And I'm like, hey, how's it going? She's like, you don't even remember last week, do you? And I'm like, I really can't say I do. I got to tell you, what'd we do? And she's like, oh, we made out for a while. And I'm like, oh, God damn. And Ed let me do it and laughed.
I don't remember any of that.
Now I just take the bullet for other comics when I'm on the road because I won't fool around. So I'll keep the fat chick at bay. You know, she'll come with the hot friend. So the other comic's hitting on the hot friend. And I'll keep the fat girl, you know, away from them and keep her occupied and try to get an assist. You know what I mean? I'll wrap it up. We'll talk about how we like our steaks done. It's beautiful. I swear to God, what diners are open 24 hours? Seriously, and I'll keep her up, and she won't bother the hot one. You know, she won't get jealous. Absolutely.
What does an assist get you? Just like something?
Just a point.
Oh, okay.
You know what I mean? It's just
yeah,
makes
your
you feel
buddy
good.
Owes you at that point.
Yeah, I would start asking for things. If I had friends like that, I'd be like, you know, 3 points, get you a case of beer.
No, as long as I hear the story in the morning, what happened with the hot one.
Pictures, yeah. You got to have pictures.
Yeah, dude, I finally fell off the wagon. I was drinking non-alcoholic beer for the last 5 weeks.
Yeah, you called me, and I was like, why?
And you know what? I realized that the wagon is a slow, monotonous ride. Mm-hmm. The only sort of entertainment or, you know, the occasional engine to shoot or something. I fell off, and I'm back to drunk driving.
I last about 4 days, and I just start getting really jittery, and my friends start to hate me because I got too much energy, and they're just like, yeah, you got to go out. All right, I'll go drinking.
Yeah, Laz walked out of the porno shoot last week and went right to the Tracy. I need beers.
That's what did it. That's what threw me.
He was like, that was crazy.
I had to have a drink after sitting in a director's chair at a porn shoot where literally 10 feet away, there's two chicks and a guy just all over each other.
And that and the guy's penis that touched you, so.
And no, it didn't touch me. But I did.
How close?
Hopefully it didn't arc one on you.
No.
How close?
It arced. I seen arcage.
Trust me.
How close was his
junk.
Nude penis or junk?
I would say probably about a foot away.
I got to go a little. I'm a carpenter. A little less than a foot.
Really?
It was a little less than a foot.
How many veins did you see?
We had his measuring tape out.
I had my recorder, and I was like sitting there interviewing him, and I was doing my. I couldn't look down. You know, but it's like when you're standing at a urinal and you look over, you gotta.
You look over?
Sure.
Boy, you are gay. But I've never looked over once.
The best.
Gym, I try not to look over. Yes, on purpose.
The best part of the porn shoot that we went to is when the chicks and the guy and the director get in the huddle and they go through this whole. It sounds like a playbook. They're like, "All right, we're going to start with ATM, reverse ATM. Then I want you to do a reverse cowgirl into. I mean, they have like all these every move.
It's like a playbook.
It's like a playbook.
Docking positions.
Yeah, exactly. I was like, wow. And I came home. And I was talking to my
guess
girl.
Guess what I learned?
I go, learned about the reverse cowgirl. Didn't really know that position existed, but...
Are you serious?
That's like my favorite. Love it.
What, reverse cowgirl?
Oh, yes.
Come
I had that
on.
This morning.
I didn't know it had a name.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
See, do you actually throw your hand around in a circle over your head and scream yeehaw?
No. She's
the one that's throwing a hand. Yeehaw!
That's who is gay, isn't it?
If you need me, Reed and I will be riding through Chelsea as I.
I was hoping Reed had a fat chick story. He seemed to clam up back then. Any fat chick stories?
Come on, Reed.
No fat chick stories.
Not that he's going to tell.
He's not lucky to have girl stories. I don't have any fat chick stories.
You lucky to have girl, you have guy stories?
What? No guy stories, no.
See, Reed was a very pure person, and he and I were working at this ad agency. He would actually give me little, like, anti-drug lectures. And then all of a sudden, he went to go work for Time Out New York and hang out with all these people that, you know, wear black turtlenecks and smoke clove cigarettes and say witty garbage about some play that nobody's seen. And so he starts running with all these cultural people. And, of course, all the cultural people are into, you know, the various drugs and things. And next time I see Reed, it was like somebody had gone off to college. You know, they come back, the hair is a little longer. He's a little bit more experienced.
He had a homosexual experience in college, you know, all of that stuff.
Curling team.
No. Yeah, don't tell that one anymore. I'm serious. For your own good.
What?
The curling ones?
Yes, no more curling.
It was. I got paid. It was for a story.
That's what they all say. Right.
So was that thing in the bathroom stall.
Was it a homosexual experience? No, I got paid. It's different.
Oh. Dude, on the way in, I was on the train. In the train bathroom. I've now figured out why train bathrooms are so nasty. The Long Island Railroad, you know, when it goes between the electrical things, the thing's rocking like crazy, and then the lights go out. I'm like, I can't.
You get all over the walls.
Oh, dude, I couldn't hit anything. It's bad.
I love that in the airplane, you know, when you hit the turbulence. Finally, like, you can't be blamed. You just leave it and go.
So when you and I were coming back from the snowboarding in Europe, and it was the biggest bathroom I've ever seen.
Yeah, that was the sex bathroom.
They have handicapped bathrooms now that are just enormous. And I was like, and this chick was hitting on Ed. I'm like, dude, go.
Because I've always wondered, like, how do these people join the Mile High Club? That bathroom's too small. And finally, I was like, yeah. Yeah, that girl never emailed us either, did she?
Mm.
Yeah, we had a bet on who she was going to email. I think she had the hots for you. But.
I was so whacked because I ate the stash before we got to the airport.
And I tried to sleep to ignore her. I had my little eye patch on and my earplugs. And
Florentine, have you ever traveled with Ed?
No.
He has this really feminine sort of eye patch.
Feminine is black!
Like an old man wears.
What do you mean?
Right? There's like a black sort of eye mask, and he wears it in public.
I put the earplugs in, I hear, see nothing. I'm just gone. It's beautiful.
And you don't know if you're snoring?
I don't care. I could care less. As long as I just want to wake up and have it be over. I just want to be home.
Right. And then this girl brought hers over. They compared the little sleepy patches. What do you call that thing?
Mask?
Whatever. I call it...
Eye mask?
I call it really goofy. But I figured out what I'm buying you for Christmas, Ed.
Okay.
There's
this is the point where I leave.
Yeah.
Got a train. See you later,
bro. There's a company that you can buy animals for people. I guess you like donate them to, you know, villages and people that are...
Oh, you can buy a goat and send it to Kenya.
You can buy a sheep. It's only $120.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And that's a job over there. because they can't. You know, it'll produce so much milk that's not enough. It'll be too much for one family, so they sell the milk.
Basically,
you don't have to work if you have a goat.
Why don't we? I don't know. Like Sam Kinison used to say, "Why don't we send them a U-Haul?" Don't like animals make more animals? Why do they need me to FedEx them a bunny? You can buy people bunnies.
What are they going to do with a bunny? Eat it?
I guess the bunnies make a lot more bunnies.
Yeah, they do.
And then you eat them. Though I've never really had bunny. Eating bunny?
No.
No?
I eat hamburger. I'm white trash from Jersey. No bunny.
What's,
Ranch One.
Oh.
Quiznos, underrated.
You ever had ranch on pizza? That's good.
No.
Yeah,
chicken ranch pizza is good.
Yeah. I used to work at a pizza place. You dip ranch dressing on a pizza, especially pepperoni pizza.
See, I haven't eaten today, so I'm starving.
You're over there eating pistachios.
That's not food. I was telling my girlfriend,
don't make out with that.
If there's not meat involved, it's not a meal. It's a side dish. You gotta have some meat. Throw some meat there.
Right, she's a vegetarian?
No, she's not. But she's like, oh, let's have a salad. I'm like, what have we got? What else are we gonna have? You know, like eggs to me is not even a meal. You gotta have bacon or ham or scrapple or sausage.
Yeah, my girlfriend's a vegetarian, so sometimes it's a problem.
Sometimes.
Yeah, you know, when we go out, you know, I can't take her to a Taco Bell or anything like that.
Well, what about the bean burritos?
Yeah, they have the vegetarian menu, actually, now.
Don't understand, like, how a woman goes from, like, 19 or 20, like, these hot chicks, they'll go to Taco Bell and eat there three times a day, no problem. Then they hit, like, 23 or 24 and they need the best steakhouse or whatever, the best restaurant, and they won't settle for less. What happened in those 5 years where it takes a turn? What happens?
They realize the power.
Exactly.
Is that right? Yeah. At 19, like, oh, I eat Taco Bell at 3 in the morning. I don't care. I'll eat it in the morning.
Yeah, at 19, they're becoming a woman, but they don't understand the power of a woman at that point. So they get one guy who buys them something nice and ruins it for the rest of their life.
That's what it is, right?
Yep. Well, that's why I bang fat chicks, and they, you know, in college, bang fat chicks. They buy you stuff.
Plus, they know the best place to eat.
And they pay for it.
And there's not too many fat...
Oh, you can eat buffets.
I've never met a fat vegetarian.
Yeah, you're right.
You know? That's because they need a little protein.
Yeah.
So I'm happy to avoid.
That's what's good about my girlfriend, you know, being a vegetarian. She's got to get a protein source from somewhere.
Yeah. That was gone. So you can go see.
Here's a shooter, honey.
You can go see. Come in a test tube. You're going to be at the Laugh Factory on Thursday.
Laugh Factory Thursday night in New York City, 42nd and 8th, and Friday, Saturday, Sunday at Rascals in Nyack at that big mall.
Aren't you doing some more dates later this month?
Thought
I saw on your
in
website.
Philly and Vegas, I'm doing.
Cool. And the website is jimflorentine.com. If you want to check out, you've got some Crank Anchors bits on there, some stand-up clips. And ComedyCentral.com has got all your new stuff that you're doing with...
Meet the Creeps.
Meet the Creeps, which those are absolutely hysterical. You got to check that out. Cousin Ed is at CousinEd.com. That's CouzinEd.com.
It's still not working.
Are you serious? Oh, yeah, it's true. I went to your website the other day.
My web guy's the worst. I was like, stability of my job right now is a little shaky. This is like 2 months ago. So I'm really going to need that website up. Okay, I'll get right on it. Still down. I'm working on
these
a new one.
These techie nerds, they want to do all the stuff for you, but then they never get it done.
Well, right. Now he's like, well, I have this other person who's paying me 12 grand a year. What are you giving me? Free drinks, dude. That's worth more than 12 grand. You come around, hang around me enough.
He tries to hang around me, too. He emails me, hey, man.
I don't pay for his drink. I just take him to places where I get it for free. He doesn't know.
Why don't you just pay somebody, you cheap bastard?
For what?
To do your website. Yeah. Florentine, who does your website?
Yeah, I got a guy in Texas.
You pay him?
I pay him, yeah, here and there. But he's still, you know, the guy's missing for like 4 or 5 days.
Yeah.
And then he's always, I got a newer version. I'm like, just put the friggin' dates up. Don't worry about that stuff. These techie guys drive me nuts. These techie guys, like, these guys have never gotten laid. Which isn't good, because then they don't know how to set stuff up. Like, if you go, you know, your email, you know, you throw it in the trash, it's there for like 3 days. Like, MySpace is a big thing now, you know what I mean? So they keep your sent letter. You don't need that if you're trying to hook up with some chick or something like that. If these techie nerds got laid and did that stuff, they would make sure you could never find an old email ever.
Right.
But these guys never went through that. They're even taking it out on us scumbags, going, you know what, I'm going to get them caught. I didn't get laid in high school, so we're going to save this stuff for 3 days so your frigging girlfriend or wife can find it.
Right.
You know what I mean?
My guy thinks he's a comedian, too. I always, like, instant message me, like, jokes during the show. And they're not funny. And he's like, what do you mean? It's funny, isn't it? No. It's not.
No, it's not funny. It's not funny at the office.
Get back to your Linux penguin.
Yeah, put my site up, dude, and stop worrying about the damn jokes.
Right. We would be in role reversal, and I would be sitting around mounting hard drives or playing with my floppy disk or whatever. This is from your brother, Cousin Ed, Old Wooly Barley Wine Ale.
Yeah, he said you were going to lie and keep it. He goes, I gave him two bottles, so don't let him say
if you drink this whole
bottle,
you're going to be smashed because it's like
what percentage is
12%
it?
Alcohol or something.
Oh, so
it's massive.
Pound this and drive home.
Florentine, thanks for coming on the show.
Thanks for having me again, man. I appreciate it.
And Cousin Ed, will we see you next week?
No, I got a Eagles game that day. I got to work.
All right. Well, you guys are leaving early.
I'll see you on the 15th, Florentine.
All right.
Yep.
We'll be right back after this. You all right, Reed?
I had to adjust.
Okay.
Some people have left the building, so you gotta take care of that.
93K Rocket is the Lazlow Show. Cousin Ed and Jim Florentine have left the building. Those guys party a lot together down in Philly.
Seems so.
Florentine gave us like $200 worth of his CDs, his live stand-up, the Meet the Creeps. We're all set up.
Yes, sir.
I'm down with it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm into it. I'm looking forward to this bit here called Sniffing Panties on Meet the Creeps. I don't know what it's about, but I like the picture on the back.
Yeah. I like the picture of...
I took it down.
What is it?
It's a picture of Nick Carter.
No, it's not really Nick Carter. It's like the front of the New York Post.
Look at the front of the Post and that guy that was claimed to be the fireman torturous rapist, I think is what he was.
Peter Brownstein or something.
There's an incredible resemblance to Nick Carter. You don't think so? Look at this picture.
I know. He does look a lot like Nick Carter.
It could be
all
Nick.
All he needs is...
If I see Nick with one of those FDNY t-shirts, I'd have to give the police a call.
You love Nick Carter.
He's a great guy. Does an absolutely wonderful show. Why'd you get quiet?
Nothing. I try to cause trouble. That is my job.
Yeah, well, I don't know. He said something about Big Wayne being a racist before I came on, so.
Yeah, see, I don't think you're racist. You're just comedy.
I like the comedy value of it.
You like the comedy value?
Yeah, I can laugh at a white joke just as much as I can as a black joke or a Spanish joke.
So you're equally offensive to everyone is what you're saying.
Offensive to the comedy value, yes.
And it doesn't even make sense.
Yes, it all has comedy value.
Should mention that if you want to send in something to the show, considering that we're getting an email from Panama and Africa, the website's lazlow.com, and every show that we've done since July is on there. And if we disappear into the night, then you'll find out on that page as we celebrate our firing or whatever happens.
I think you got 3 more weeks.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Well, whatever.
Yeah, it's all good.
What are you going to do on Sunday nights? What did you do last Sunday when we were not...
the appointment night got switched over to Sunday night.
I love that Wayne, when we play Best Of, likes to sit and listen to himself.
Why not? He got a review.
He's taking notes.
It's a little...
little what?
It's just a little crazy.
It's not crazy. You don't listen to yourself?
I have to review it to make sure that there's no curses on it and all that
and
stuff.
You also have to review it for just to make sure it sounds good.
Sure.
So, I have to make sure that it sounds good, even though I have no control over the sound.
Yeah, I was poking around these video websites where the clips are posted. It is now to the point where anything embarrassing you do in public is going to be recorded by somebody's camera phone. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of these camera phones shoot video now. Everybody seems to have a video camera, a handheld camcorder, and anything you do crazy is going to end up on the internet. Even when you get pulled over by a cop now, they record it.
You know, the cops do, you mean?
Sure, they got a camera.
Yeah, on the dashboard, yeah.
On the dashboard. Can't get away with nothing. I was checking out this dude. He was getting towed. And, I was towed within the last year by those fascists in Long Beach... At the Long Beach Vacuum.
You better watch what you're saying, buddy.
You know what? There's a racket, the guy that owns that parking lot between the Long Beach Vacuum.
That's known everywhere, dude.
Huh? You just fell into like the loop.
I fell in. $150 to drop my car.
I never told you, but the morning I took Jeff Hubbard up to Kennedy at 5 o'clock in the morning.
Famous bodyboarder Jeff Hubbard.
I dropped him off at 5 o'clock in the morning. Me being all cool. I'm from New York. I'm gonna leave my car, Jeff. I'll help you with your luggage. Come back. It's on the lift.
You never told me that.
Yeah, it was a little embarrassing. I was trying to be Mr. Cool, you know, host, you know. And sure enough, it cost me, I think it was $60 to drop it off the lift.
$60, dude. $150.
You got to grease the guy, or is this going straight to the city?
Well, no, he actually just got it on the hitch, and I came out, and I was like, oh, what are you doing? He's like, hey, you can't leave your car here. This is after post 9/11. I was like, I don't care what it is.
That's all they have to do now. It's just evoke 9/11, and they can take anything. Like, recently, the judge, you know, the New York Civil Liberties Union or whatever said that it's a wee bit constitutional for police to just come pat you down and, like, search your stuff. Which they've been doing in the subways, right? If you don't want to ride the subway, you know, if you don't agree to it, you can't ride the subway. You have to leave. So they went to this judge, and the judge said, well, you know, the First Amendment and, you know, the Constitution in this case, you know, protecting from terrorism is more important. So we'll just toss everything out.
That's how it begins, baby.
That's how it begins. Mm. Then you got these fools over in Iraq planting a news story. Did you see that?
Yeah.
Dude, it's embarrassing.
What? Everything that is like in the First Amendment, I mean, we've just trampled on.
It's crazy. It's like we are paying to put propaganda stories in Iraqi newspapers, and they're actually paying off newspapermen over there to write positive articles.
What happened to respecting the press? Everything we just—they nobody
it's
just
so
cares.
And when they have these press conferences now with these troops,
those impromptu press conferences.
It's so disrespectful to the men and women of the military that they are like sitting there making them rehearse a script and then lying and saying that this is an impromptu question and answer, and then they get busted with it. It's just like, you know, mission accomplished, propaganda. Like every time, if they were just straight about it, I'd be totally cool with it.
I know.
But it's like, it's like when we went to the porn shoot. When you see behind the curtain, it just ruins everything.
Didn't ruin it for me. Just made me look at every individual I know in my life that there's something that goes on in that behind their closed doors that ain't right.
So here's a guy recently spazzing out getting his car towed, and it was filmed, and now people are mocking him because the guy just lost it. He's thrown himself.
Wait, this is a guy?
This is a guy.
Girl. I know. He sounds like a chick.
He's thrown himself on the hood of the car. You got to see this clip.
What did you do to my car? Please call the police on this guy. Somebody help me.
I think he's on the shuffling team.
Right. Sounds a little light in the loafers.
This is not even right. Somebody help me. Why are you doing this? I have proof at my house when I work at the chiropractor.
I asked you for proof.
You didn't give me a chance to come down.
You said you were going to call the police on me.
Because he took my car and he started to drive off with my car when I have proof that I work at
the chiropractor. I love it.
This guy walks up to him because he's completely spazzing out. He says, are you on the goddamn planet? Like,
to the guy that's freaking out. Yeah.
To the freaking out guy. It's just like a local guy walking by and he sees him. He's like, dude, are you on planet Earth? Your car's getting towed.
Yeah, have some dignity. Don't cry for $100 or whatever. Just pay it off. Be a man.
I'm going to drive off with my car when I have proof that I work at
the goddamn planet. Are you on the planet?
I don't have the money to
get off of the car.
I don't have the money.
The man has a legal right to tow this. They're going to lock your ass. They're going to lock your ass up at the cops get here. Hello. We have a contract with that hospital right there.
The hospital?
901 Dover.
He just drove off with my car. I'm going to call my lawyer then.
Call your lawyer. It's as of right now, it's $92. It's not $45 anymore.
Now, at that point, I sort of felt sorry for him because it's like, those guys jacking, and you know they put the money in their pocket.
Oh, no doubt.
I mean, the sissification there.
But the thing is, he says he doesn't have money to pay the ticket, but then he's going to call a lawyer, and just to get a lawyer on the phone is like $2,000, you know? You ever called a lawyer? They ain't going to do anything for $45.
You may see an ad that says a free independent counsel. You ever had a lawyer?
Yeah.
What a shock.
But of course Wayne has.
Right, Wayne's had a lawyer.
Yeah.
So how are you about, just excited that you're leaving for Christmas?
Sure.
I'm really jealous, dude. I am so jealous of Wayne.
20 more days and I'm outie.
He's flying straight to Jamaica, and while everybody is, you know, having to deal with horrible family.
Worried about Santa touch their kids.
And buying, you know, all sorts of...
I love that. Makes me want to be a Santa Claus.
With that beard, you could.
Yeah.
But I had this whole thing, and I did Santa Claus once in my life for some nephews. Mm-hmm. And I'm a firm believer that mommy should come sit on your lap.
You are such a pervert.
Oh, yes.
That's not what Christmas is about.
No.
I don't think.
You know what, dude? What
it's really, about something different to everybody.
What drives me nuts is Fox News is running these segments now saying that there's a war on Christmas, which if it's like any of the other wars that we've declared on anything, nothing gets done about. Like the war on drugs, working fantastically.
Oh, we've won that one.
We've
just
won
like the
that.
War on terrorism. Now we're moving on to the war on porn and decency. And apparently Christmas.
But they've got, you know, they're running these things, you know, the war on Christmas, saying that the, you know, the liberals are attacking Christmas and it's going to cause the stock market to drop and ruin the American economy. Because that's really what Christmas is about. Is about the dough.
It's about money, yeah.
It is about the money.
I'm so sick of hearing all these predictions of, like, this Walmart in Idaho did 10% business down on Black Friday. You know what? You know, all these predictions about how much money people spent and stuff like that. It's all over the news.
I heard another little thing that Black Friday no longer is considered the biggest shopping day.
I think it never was.
It's the Saturday before Christmas, they say now.
Or Christmas Eve.
It's when the most bonus money is given out.
It's just a myth.
But it's like...
But it also has gotten to the point where, come on, when I was a kid, you know, maybe your mother spent $200 on you. It's like $200 today buys what, an iPod? What else do you
doesn't
give
even
the kid?
Buy an
doesn't
iPod.
Even buy a decent iPod.
No. Okay, so see, I'm out of the loop.
I mean, it's gotten bad. I mean, you just spend thousands and thousands of dollars, and they keep, like, you know, I guess they're scared that, because there's a few people saying, you know what, maybe this has gotten out of control. And also, you know, there is the, we don't want to become like Saudi Arabia, you know, and have like state institutionalized religion, but that's what these crazy dudes want to do.
They do?
Seriously, they keep, like, they had this whole show the other day on Fox News, all these experts saying how bad, you know, the separation of church and state people are, because they, you know, and how bad it's going to be for the economy.
So Fox News is pro-Christmas, pro-Christian, is that what you're saying?
Basically, yeah. it's like watching the 700 Club with, like, you know, a flag off in the top left corner.
I know, they were all up in arms because, what was it, in Boston, they don't call it the Christmas tree anymore in the public square, they call it the holiday tree.
But it does get a little crazy.
It gets a little crazy, I agree.
I mean, you know, you can't, like, when I moved to New York, and, you know, and I said Christmas, and people were like, no, it's holiday, because in the Midwest, you say Christmas.
I said Christmas my whole life.
Because I met one Jewish person when I lived in Oklahoma, and they owned all the restaurants that I worked at.
Where you went on Christmas Day.
No, it was Sonic. You like a Sonic? I love a Sonic. You ever been to Sonic?
I love it. Everything is covered in cheese there.
Know.
It's like,
they
you know,
melt
get a tater tots covered in cheese, a drink covered
in
cheese.
You get, that's why people in the Midwest are so fat. When you can get cheese-covered tater tots, you don't even have to get out of your car. Roll up and you roll the window down and you push a button and you're like, yo, I want cheese-covered tater tots. And they got all sorts of crazy... I used to work at Sonic and make the crazy drinks back there.
Yeah.
Dude, mad sugar. The vanilla Cokes and the lime... slushies and all that stuff.
Now all the commercials push that stuff for breakfast. It's like, get your day going with a lime cherry Coke. Yeah, that'll get your day going. When I was down in North Carolina, you know, eating at these barbecue places, one of the drinks that they had at all these like roadside stands was called a witch doctor. And you know what that is? You ever heard of that?
No.
They don't have that up here. It's cherry Sprite. This drink called Sun Drop, which is sort of like Mountain Dew. So it's those two mixed together, and then they top it off with dill pickles.
What?
Yeah. So it's got a little pickle juice, so it's like sweet and sour. The sweet of the cherry Sprite, and then the sour of the pickle.
It's
called a witch doctor.
That's crazy.
I know.
I think we should make some. Did you have one?
Yeah.
That's crazy.
I put a little absinthe in mine, though. Just kidding.
You're going to bring the bottle on.
I know.
Week,
Ed's all fired up for absinthe. He got out his calendar before he's leaving. He's like, yo, dude, you got to bring the bottle in the 18th. I'll be in here the 18th.
That sounds good.
You know what? You can buy it on the internet.
That's what I said.
They will ship it straight to you.
That's what I said.
I don't need to own my own bottle. I want two shots, like Ed said. Come
You're
on the air.
You're not doing two shots. Every time I've hung out with you, it's always, I'm going to do two shots. I put a bottle of Absolute down in front of Wayne at my house, and he just sits there and keeps pouring shots. Bang, 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 and the bottle will be gone.
I will bring it in, but I will bring in a limited amount.
Yeah, no, I just heard so much about it.
It's not that good. Lazlow, back me up here.
The taste is horrendous.
It tastes like sort of like licorice. Right?
Yeah, tastes like licorice. That's okay. Cough syrup.
NyQuil.
The buzz is good. I got to tell
it's
you,
it's good, but it's not crazy.
I was
you're
told
not
it's like hallucinogenic.
You're not going to be seeing fairies
maybe
and
maybe
stuff.
The aid shots.
Well, after you do a few shots, I mean, you know what? It's like the early onset of mushrooms. I guess
it's a little hazy.
This whole show, man.
It's just about drugs. It's all we
how
do.
How could they not want this show on 5 days a week?
I know.
Yeah.
The website for the show is lazlow.com. You can catch, if you missed an hour or two of this show or previous episodes, you can download them. They're in their entirety without commercials or songs.
Right, or if for some reason you're in Africa and are listening to the show.
Dude, it's so weird, the email that we get. How did people find this show?
It's because you're a famous guy.
No, it's not. It's because people just troll the internet and you come across garbage. And people in Africa obviously have a lot of time on their hands because all their relatives are dying.
Wow.
You like that?
Everything just ground to a screeching halt.
Do we get to the Reed's calendar quick?
Oh, yeah.
Can we say that?
Oh, you want to? Yeah, sure.
So it's a famous sports team.
Yeah, we won't say.
Who evidently Yoko Ono works with.
Yep.
So we can't say what sports team it is. Let's say, are they basketball?
They're basketball.
It's a basketball team. And they, yeah. You got a calendar, and now, you know, and it's got all the, I guess they're the cheerleaders?
That's right. You know, and most of these sports teams put out this calendar with, you know, every month is a different cheerleader for their team. But I got an autographed one, and... I got to tell you.
Personalized autographs.
They personalized it.
It's like, is it like they wrote in your yearbook kind of thing? Like, I'm going to write in your crack.
Exactly. This big bubble writing. They dotted their I's with a heart.
I hope, have a good summer. I hope we have a period together next year. And I mean both kinds.
K-I-T.
K-I-T. What's that?
Keep in touch.
Oh.
You never wrote that in the yearbook?
How about Y-I-C?
What's that?
Yours in Christ.
You do not get that.
Dude, there's all sorts of...
But you weren't anyone's in Christ, were you?
I wasn't... Huh? There's all sorts of religious stuff. I'll bring my yearbooks in.
Yours in Christ?
Sure, there's... Dude, I grew up in, like, Footloose. What do you... I've told you the stories. We weren't allowed to dance. We weren't allowed to go to movies.
I know, but I didn't think people were drinking that Kool-Aid. I thought you guys were, like, rebels underneath.
Mm.
No?
I was for a while, until they asked me not to come back. But that's another show.
The state or the church?
Finish both.
Oh, yeah,
finish
exactly.
Your stupid thing.
So, yeah, you know, usually these girls just write something dumb on here. But I'm looking through this, and this is absolutely true with these girls wrote. It gets a little risque. Look at this girl. You see this girl? Her name's Cheney, which is sort of weird.
Right. And it,
dick.
Yeah, exactly. This is what she wrote in big bubble writing. Reed, you can climb me anytime.
What?
I don't know.
What is she, a mountain?
She looks pretty mountainous.
Yeah. And then look at this one. And again, I don't know if this is their stock thing that they write on this, or if they just they
it's
actually
got to be. They're not like, oh,
no,
this
no,
guy's
don't
name
blow
is
it for Reed.
But
Reed,
I don't know.
That is personalized. They don't write you that don't, on every guy's calendar.
But how did this? Okay, this is what this girl named Kara. She's looking pretty cute. She's blonde. It says, "Reed, grab the tanning oil and rub. My shoulders are starting to burn."
Oh God,
that's what is. What does that even mean?
I mean, she's getting hot.
But
I mean, she wants your.
Do you honestly think? Do you think she sat down and thought of that? Or that's like, I mean, what if an 8-year-old kid comes up? You think she writes the tanning oil line on the 8-year-old kid's calendar?
No.
No, I don't think so either. This is my favorite one. You guys see this one?
Oh, it's
Erica.
A
here she is.
Honey.
Here she is in a white bathing suit standing by the pool, and it says, mm-mm-mm, baby boy, B-O-I, how about a taste of honey? That's pretty dirty.
And so... Why did you get this calendar?
Well, I don't know.
Your girl got it for you?
She got it for
as
me.
As a joke?
Eh, sort of. But I can't...
I don't know what's more pathetic. The fact that you own that...
But look at this. Look what they wrote. It's not just dumb... Oh, hey, Reed.
Are you going to be permitted to hang that in the apartment?
Well, I wouldn't hang this in my apartment. Come on, man.
You wouldn't?
Why not?
Why not?
What is that? I don't work at an auto body shop. I don't live
I told you, I got a Reef Girl calendar for like the past 7 years. Hangs right next to my bed.